on and paper present during paper. If you are having a PPT that you can present on screen, otherwise you should have your camera on. You are expected to do a brief explanation of your of paper. So just introduce yourself in one or two sentences and then go ahead with your presentation. And we have 17 presenters for this session. So 17 paper presentations, 2 hours, do your calculation. So we will get around 7-8 minutes for paper presentation. So how we will go about it will be like this. Each paper presenter will make the presentation, and at the end of the presentation, the ground will be open for discussion. So we cannot have a lot of questions, but we will entertain one or two or maximum 3 questions, and then we will move on to the next paper presenter, so that the person who completes can you know, is finished. So like that, we will be going ahead with our paper presentations. Small discussion and then the second paper presentation. Anything else, if you have any doubts, you can ask, and we will improvise as we proceed. Okay, Achyuta ma'am, you can start.
Thank you, sir. Very good afternoon to one and all presented here. And I'm happy to present my paper with all you. I'm Achyuta, Assistant Professor of English, working in St. Joseph's College of Arts and Science at Cuddalore, Tamil Nadu. I would like to share my PPT for presentation. So let me turn off my camera and I'll go for a presenting. Shall I, sir?
Sure, sure. Go ahead, go ahead.
Is the screen clearly visible to everyone?
Yeah, ma'am, it's clear.
Yes, ma'am, thank you. And the title of my paper is Nature, a Tool of Defense Mechanism in a Forest, a Deer, by Ambai. So before going with this, I want to start up this presentation with a Thirukural in Tamil. Ara Iyarkai Ava Neetin Annilaye Pera Iyarkai Tharum. The meaning of this verse is, if you have deleted all your unwanted desire, truly the nature and the God will give you your desired life. Your wants and wishes will come true if you delete the unwanted desires and unwanted wishes. So with that note, I want to start up with my paper. So nature, a tool of defense mechanism. So what is defense mechanism and how it is worked here in this paper? We all have experienced mental conflicts arose due to the incompatibility of our different needs that will result in mental stress and anxiety. In that stage, we'll use certain mechanism or a certain strategy to overcome that stress. So that's called defense mechanism. So how nature is incorporated as a tool in defense mechanism is dealt here. And in this article, how the unbearable pain of Thangam, the protagonist of this story, In a Forest, a Deer, written by Ambai, has explored and overcome with the pain with the use of nature. How nature helps her to overcome all those stresses dealt here. And as an introductory section, this goes. And here's a short note of Dr. C.S. Lakshmi. She was born in 1944 in Tamil Nadu, Coimbatore. And her pen name is Ambai. That name itself reminds us of a character in Mahabharata, the most strongest women character of Mahabharata. That name, as well as all the stories and the women characters portrayed in her stories, are very strong, mentally strong. Same way, they want a kind of freedom. They want themselves to be liberated from that. And she's an author and a researcher in women's studies. She has written many short stories, novel and novella. Women and feminism is her subject of study as well as her writing. She started her literary career in 1962 with Nandimalai Charalile. And அந்தி மாலை சிறகுகள் முறியும் வீட்டின் மூலையில் ஒரு சமையலறை காட்டில் ஒரு மான் ஆல் தோஸ் ஷார்ட் ஸ்டோரிஸ் வேர் மோஸ்ட் ஃபேமஸ் ஆஃப் ஹர் அண்ட் மோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் ஹர் ஸ்டோரிஸ் வாஸ் டிரான்ஸ்லேட்டட் இன் டு இங்கிலீஷ் பை லக்ஷ்மி ஹோம்ஸ்ட்ராங் அண்ட் டிஃபென்ஸ் மெக்கானிசம் ஸோ வாட் இஸ் டிஃபென்ஸ் மெக்கானிசம் டிஃபென்ஸ் மெக்கானிசம் வாஸ் This term was first used by and coined by Sigmund Freud in his paper The Neuropsychosis of Defense in 1894 and the term itself explains that it is a in psychoanalytic theory it is a process or a group of any process that enables the mind to reach a compromise solution to conflict that cannot be resolved so all of us has a different kinds of problem those problem can be sorted out in some other way But there are certain problems which cannot be resolved. There is no solution for it. We have to face it in our life. In certain situation, we need a kind of relaxation. We need a kind of escapism mm-hmm. from that problem for a few seconds, a few minutes, or for a few days. In that way, we used to have this defense mechanism. In that situation, we used to go or travel ourselves in certain areas, which will give us a kind of relaxation. So that's called defense mechanism. It is completely based on psychoanalytic hypothesis. So what is psychoanalytic hypothesis is? This concept clearly says that there is always a conflict within the force in the mind. We have a famous saying, there is always good and evil fighting inside us. The same way we will be having so many conflicts, so many problems in our internal mind. And we used to think a lot over the problem, how will be our Say, for example, how will be our future? Will our future leads to a good, successful life? Or we want to face so much of struggle in our future? Just thinking of future itself leads us to lots and lots of problematic situation and problematic mental stress. So that's there is always a conflict there. In order to resolve that conflict and to come out of that conflict, we find to attach ourselves to certain mechanisms. That is called defense mechanism. So in some sort of extent, it is self-deceptive and often it is an unconscious process just to defend ourselves against the conflict and just to escape from frustration and anxiety. It depends upon the individual completely in which process or what strategy they use. There are nearly 60 types of defense mechanism like denial, repression, suppression, aggression, withdrawal, compensation, sublimation, identification, altruism, fantasy, passive aggression, humor, undoing, avoidance, aim inhibition, and so on. And one among that is fantasy. We all a lover of fantasy. All the human beings has their own world of fantasy. Irrespective of male or female, they have their own world of fantasy. And more commonly, and it is more associated with women. Why it is highly associated with women is they have or they want to come out of certain situation, let it be this pandemic situation itself. It can be very easily visualized that women are struggling a lot because of staying inside four walls. So they want to escape themselves. For that reason, they have this habit of fantasy. Fantasy means they started daydreaming. All the impossible events will be possible and it is made possible in their world of fantasy. They make their mind endlessly wander all over the world. They used to see all the pleasant imageries. They will be gratified with all the wishes and desires they want. Simply, all impossibilities will be a possible notion in this fantastic world. So women is highly associated with the world of fantasy and this world of fantasy gives them a kind of relaxation for a few minutes or for a few days. If it is under their control, it gives them a kind of pleasure and it will be a good relaxation for them and they can travel to their next sort of life and the next moment and they can continue their life in a very good, happy, positive mood. If it is not under their control, it leads to psychological defects. When it is under control, it is a good form of relaxation. So the same way here, nature is taken as a tool of defense mechanism because nature is a creator, preserver, destroyer, and nature, as all we say, the best physician. And the relationship between us and nature can't be separated. So it is an inseparable relationship. How it is inseparable? If we have too much of stress inside us, just a walk in a terrace or a walk to the beach, a walk in a park, or seeing a tree with full of blossoms, or just a grass wavering in a wind, all these things, all these pictures will take off all our stress, and it will give us all the positive vibration that we need. So he created us, as she created us, she knows how to console us. So that's the reason why she is the best physician of the world. So whenever we started imagining ourselves or connecting ourselves with nature, it is a kind of defense from the reality of life. So nature will get you certain kind of escapism from the reality for some time, and it gives you positive vibrations which will lead you to face your life, face your problems in your future. So that's the reason why nature is implied as a tool here, and how it is incorporated in the story of Ambai. In a Forrester deal, Kattil Oruman, it was written in Tamil in 2006 and was translated into English by Lakshmi Holmstrom. Here in this story, I'll just narrate the story in very short. Tangam is the protagonist. She is a not so old, 40s to 50 year old lady is there. She has crossed almost all the stages of her life except only one, that is puberty. She has not come of age and she is not capable of begetting a child. She got married. She loves her cousin, her mama, named Ekambaram, and she got married with that man. And Ekambaram too loves Tangam too a lot. All the people in the society, in their locality, loves Tangam. They don't treat Tangam in a different way, but inside of them and on their look, their face will tell that she is an incapable woman to beget a child. She was taken to different doctors, and not only the doctors, all the spiritual activities and the spiritual rituals are also followed by her just to have that stage and get the child, but all in vain. That results her in frustration, and all the members in that locality wanted to marry Ekambaram to some other girl to get a child. After hearing this, she wanted to commit suicide. She drank the juice of arli seeds. After seeing this, Ekambaram told her, "You are enough for me in my life, and I don't want another woman to get a child." Understanding all the situations and the pain of Ekambaram, Tangam accepted, and she made Sengamalam the wife of Ekambaram. The second marriage was planned and organized by Tangam, and they got married. And in that relationship, they got 7 children. She used to take care of all those children, and not only those children, all the cousin and all the children in that locality used to come for Tangam, and they have very good bedtime stories from Tangam. She used to love all the children and does all the work of women as a normal woman. Physically, she is normal. Mentally, she is normal. But she doesn't cross that stage. How her fear is overcome. She used to say the stories for the bedtime stories. In all those stories, we can find herself attached with the characters, those who are not having motherhood. Like in Ramayana, we can have Thadaka. And she used to say the story of Thadaka in the version of Tangam. She used to imagine herself and narrate the story. The same way, she started giving the stories, and her final story in the end of the story, at the end of the story, is in a forest. She used to narrate a story. Once upon a time, there was a forest. In that forest, there was a deer. So what is the story there is? A group of deer used to live in a forest. That was a happy forest. And all the needed things for the animals, it is there in that forest. So they lived a happy life. On a sudden separation, a group of deer just went to have some water. Following the current of the water, one small young deer got separated from the family, and it get entered into a new forest by the way of current. after some time, it realized that it got separated from its family. So it looked around the forest. It seemed all strange to it. It can't imagine what is there in the forest. It just closed its eyes because of seeing all those things in a strange view, in a night time. After that, he just got to see the spark of a fire, which was made by a hunter. After seeing that, he'd start hid himself, and he doesn't want to see the world of nature. And it got so fear and frightened because of all the new areas. And on a sudden point, the days rolled on like that. And after that, what happened is, on a sudden day, a full moon day, due to the bright light of the moon, it saw all the things in the forest. Complete view of the forest is seen by him. It just identified and related the past trees, leaves, lake, stream, different kinds of animals. Everything is there in the same way as it is now. So understanding the situation, it is not a different forest or a strange one. It is also a forest, but we are new to this forest and we have to let this life. So this is the story given by her. She just, Ambai, C.S. Lakshmi wants to compare Tangam with the deer and the situation of loss of motherhood with a forest. And in this way, when Tangam, at the end of the story, we can see Tangam used to say the story, and after finishing the story, at the close of this complete story, she used to cross her leg, get close her legs to herself and crossed her hands, and used to have a style of fright, fear. What I want to convey from this is, just as she compared Tangam with the deer and the forest with the new situation, why she used this is, Tangam needs a companion, because all the people in the society, in their area, are living a very happy life. Ekambaram doesn't have any child before, but after getting married to Senkamalam, he too has a child and he is settled in his family. And all other people used to have their normal way of living. But only for Tangam, it is not complete for her. So in order to get her life companion, she just compared herself with nature, just to escape her stress. So in a fear that she doesn't have anyone else as a companion for her, she got nature as a companion and she compared herself with the deer and she made herself console that you're not alone, you're like a deer in a new forest. Start accepting all your new situations and travel with this new situation. Be positive and don't have a negative feeling. This life is also true and it is also a good way of living. So when you compare yourself with nature, you will have a kind of positivity. So that's it. Nature never did betray the heart that loved her, as Wordsworth say. So be with nature. So be with her, preserve her, protect her, portray her, worship her, and finally surrender yourself to her, because in her lies everything that we search in this material world. So that's the end of my presentation. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for the nice presentation. It was a very interesting presentation on Ambai and the deers and the story. It was very interesting, and the analysis was also done very succinctly. Now, the stage is open for discussion. Any questions? You can turn on your audios and you can ask the question. Okay, let us assume that everybody wants to present and nobody wants to ask, because you receive what you give. So if you ask questions, you will also be asked questions. So everybody is being very careful. That is good. So due to time constraints, let us draw that session to a close. So that was a wonderful presentation, Ambai, and what the role of nature is, nature as a preserver, as a protector. It was a very good discussion. Now that session is over. I call on the next person to make the presentation, but make sure in your presentations don't narrate the stories, because it is all good to have stories, it is good to listen to stories, but we have lot of time constraints. 17 papers we have to present, and we have only two and a half hours, so 5-7 minutes, that is the maximum that we can get. This presentation went almost 15-20 minutes. It was good, we enjoyed, but dear paper presenters, we have to accommodate everyone. It is about the subaltern, and don't cross the borders, time borders. The next paper presenter, who is it?
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Alfiamol KA, a PG student. She is going to present a paper titled Gender Equality in Household Works, in aspect of Julia Alvarez's poem Women's Work. So it's a poem. I hope she will be able to make a good presentation. Be calm and cool, make a very good presentation, but only worry about the time. No, worry nothing else. Just make a good presentation and convey your idea. What is the central idea of your presentation? That is what we have to convey. Instead of narrating a lot of stories, we can that is how we can save time. Okay, please go on, Alfia Mol. Your audio is muted. Please unmute yourself.
Am I audible?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Alfia, first year MA student at Indira Gandhi College, Nellikuli. My paper is titled Gender Equality in Household Work, in aspect of Julia Alvarez's poem Woman's Work. Through this poem, Julia Alvarez opened the subject of the domestic role of women in family life. The story tells about the mother's obsessive housekeeping that influences the speaker's future life. The speaker depicts and criticizes her mother's active domestic role, but admits it has influenced her becoming a woman working at home herself. The daughter, the protagonist, and the speaker of the poem start with a rhetoric question: who says a woman's work is in a high art? This was probably one of her mother's favorite phrases while the latter performed her domestic chores. Then she speaks about the family whose hearts embodied the addresses of the house. Her mother cared for so much, and emphasizing that the mother's care and love was embodied in the housekeeping chores. The speaker's mother was most probably not employed and focused on all her attention to keeping a perfect house. The daughter was engaging in doing woman's work from an early age. She was frustrated to hear her friends play outside while she was obliged to clean the house. Her mother calls a woman's work high art, the other calls it hard. Concentrating merely on domestic chores made the speaker unhappy and becoming grown up. She complains about her mother's strictness and obsessions with keeping the house clean. Despite disliking the routine of the housekeeping, the speaker admits mother was artful and housewife. The speaker also admits that because of her beat, she was considered her mother's masterpiece. In this piece of literature that I have selected for presentation here, what I mainly intended to discuss is how women are discouraged and their spirit undermined for pursuing job. The poet says that the women are too weak to take up jobs that requires high level of expertise and professional perfection, as well as that requires high amount of hard work and human endeavors. Women take up and do a number of jobs.
Komal Rao, please mute your audio. Komal Rao, please mute your audio. Others, please mute. Only the speaker needs to unmute. Everyone else, please mute your audios. Komal Rao. Okay, continue. Sorry.
But the fact that men do not recognize the extent of the difficulty and dignity of their work is something that's very frustratingly painful and disappointing for women. Who is then forced to be clinical about themselves that whatever harder jobs are they doing too, still men never recognizes them and they just want them doing things regularly in the mechanical manner. And they just want to keep things going and done neatly. No matter how much pain and suffering do the women who are doing, these are actually tolerating to satisfy their male counterparts. It's very sad that men are too narrow-minded and they maintain a constructive outlook toward women capability. How far they can go laboring and working hard to be strong and important player in life along with men. The men should be able to understand how grievously do many and all of women suffer will during various things and their suffering are actually done for sake of men's comfortable and sake of being at home and men's satisfaction and happiness at home. Even though women could not then be happy because of their works and dedications for men are not often recognized by men because of this a predominant notion among men that has been taught to them and passed on them by their previous generations, having infused a religious belief blindly and slavishly that women are supposed to remain always subservient and subordinate to men. As a conclusion to this analysis of the poem, Woman Work, which I have attempted here to showcase women's plight caused by unacceptance and unrecognition of their works. However, great are they, and they and those who work done by women and the male-dominated society highly indifferent and heedless attitudes towards women. I actually bring to your attention to the absolute fact that although a man cannot see the depth of the hardship that this woman counterpart suffers in doing every work and duties of her. It does not mean that those works are easier to do and therefore need to be respected and considered with heed of a heel sympathy and compassion for women. Means men's empathetic attitude and support of women what they expect from men the most. In this poem, through this poet wants to convey the mass of the readers is that however simplistic and silly to do their works may appear to men in their constructed mentally and narrow-minded, prejudiced outlook towards women. Those works of women are that these men seem to be of no importance as respect, involve as a lot of hardship and sufferings that women tolerate silently for the sake of the secure being to their men, and it shows their dedication and devotion towards men. Thank you all. That's all my presentation.
Okay, that was a very good presentation, and it was very heartening to listen to that presentation on two counts. One, this was a presentation made by a PG student, and she was very courageous and she was very confident, calm and composed. Good presentation. And secondly, I found it simple but beautiful. The language, there weren't too many tough vocabulary or so-called research vocabulary or anything, but it was presented beautifully. The ideas were conveyed and the ideas were clear as well. How women and their roles, women's role, subordination, how the patriarchy, oppression, all those things were succinctly portrayed in that paper. It was a very good paper, and it was also interesting because it was on a poem. Very rarely we find paper presentations being done on poetry. So very good. It was a good presentation. And any questions? Do we have any questions? I guess from the next presentation onwards, if there is any question, you can post the question, type the question in the chat box itself, so that we don't have to waste time for waiting for questions. You can post the questions in the chat box, and if there are questions, the paper presenter can respond to those questions from the chat box directly. So that can be done. So that was a very interesting presentation. We have had two beautiful presentations. This was on Julia Alvarez's poem Women's Work, and it summarized what women's work is all about and how it is less privileged and felt subaltern. So the next paper is also by a PG student, which is very good, Atisha K.A. She will present a paper titled Patriarchy in Indian Marriages in Perspective of Asha Purna Devi's Matchbox. Okay, Atisha, please unmute yourself and start your presentation. Yeah.
Hello, everyone.
Am
I audible?
Yes, yes, please go ahead.
Hello everyone, my name is Adisha K, first year MA English student of St. Peter's College, Kolanjeri, Kerala. My paper is titled Patriarchy in Indian Marriages in Perspective of Ashapurna Devi's Matchbox. Matchbox is Ashapurna Devi's story about Nomida, a young woman, beautiful woman from a poor family married to Ajit, who is from a wealthy Jolian family only because of her beauty alone. The core of the rising action in this story is related with the crumbled letter which Ajit purposefully concealed from Nomida. When she chanced to find that letter sent by her mother in Ajit's pocket, the conflicts begin. Nomida's fury relied on the fact that her husband maintained this ugly habit, though she had resisted it many times with her anger, offenses, reproaches, humiliation, sarcasms, etc. A violent argument follows, which leads to the climax of the story, in which Nomida tortures her sari's angel and Ajit rises to action in no time by extinguishing the fire, and this leads to the falling action in the story and final resolution. Now, let us take a look onto patriarchy in Indian marriage. Marriage is an institution in society and is considered the most important in one's life, especially for women, as if one's existence is void and has no value if they don't get married. It has always been an unavoidable and inevitable stage of life, and depending on the society, it has rules of prescribed age limit as to when one should get married. For many families, it is more like a social necessity and pride to get married, giving how big wedding to the groom's family rather than the feeling of the couple. And for the middle class and the lower class sections, it is more of a release of burden and responsibility. Women are still forced into marriage for social and economic security. Being independent and making their own decisions seem like a goal for women to achieve after their marriage, but she doesn't have the liberty to make decisions of alone. And now let's move on to the story. Here, the author Ashapurna Devi compares women to matchboxes, because even though they have enough gunpowder to set off 100 lengas aflame, they seek meek and innocent in kitchen, pantry, even in the bedrooms. Women are of the same way. Even though they have materials to set off mini raging fires, they don't flare up, and as matchboxes sit, they also make sit meek and innocent. And this same behavior of women can also be seen in this same character Nomida. She also doesn't behave anything rudely to her husband, who insulted her old widowed mother and rudely behaved to her. And she just tried to congest their quarrel in between the four walls of their bedroom, and doesn't want to burn her husband high mindedness and colorful shells. Marriage, from the emancipated women's point of view, could be a modern form of slavery due to the preordained future. There are patriarchal factors which ensure that women should move into their husband's house after marriage, while the women are often judged mainly by their looks and meekness. Men, in contrast, are deemed worthy by their bank balance. In Indian society, women are conditioned from birth to be subservient to her future husband and his family. Parents find marriage as only option to provide a safe life to their daughters. Marriage in this background doesn't lose its traditional value, and rather patriarchy has transformed marriage into a market in a friendly way. Compromising and not being valued are two different things in marriage. It is important to everyone to understand the different to eliminate patriarchy in marriage. Initiative have to be taken by both men and women. It has to start from childhood, where both boys and girls are taught about equality. Women have to be encouraged to understand their rights and give importance to self-respect rather than to be get compromised. Schools and NGOs needs to spread awareness about women's rights and break the stereotypes of gender. Media can also play a significant role through their content on breaking gender roles and stereotyping in advertisement, web series, and movies. It took a long way to reach here. It will take the same amount of time to eradicate this belief system if not addressed at the earliest to suit the changing times. And I'm concluding here. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, that was a wonderful matchbox presentation. A lot of matchsticks, and I love the phrase, women have a number of matchsticks under their disposal to burn number of Lenkas. That was very nice. It was a very interesting and very smart presentation. You did very well. I think we don't have any questions. You have analyzed the story beautifully, and you have given some suggestions as well what should be done. So that is done as well. And what has attracted you to this story? And is it like you felt yourself identifying with the character, or is it like you were interested in the story writer? What was it?
We have this story. I have studied this story on my +2 classes. From that sequence, I have much interested in this story. And taking a case of our society, there are many women who are suffering these kinds of atrocities from men. So that may be the reason which led to me.
Okay. Very sensible. Very good. Thank you for that wonderful presentation. I hope everyone enjoyed it. Thank you. And now I call on our next presenter, Ms. Ayushi Sharma. She's a PhD scholar, and she will make a presentation titled From Resistance to Resilience: Feministic Development in Select Novels of Shashi Deshpande. So, please.
Before I start, sir, am I audible and visible?
Yes, go ahead.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Ayushi Sharma. I'm a research scholar of Pune University. I'm pursuing a PhD in feminism, and today I'm here to present a paper entitled Resistance to Resilience: Feministic Development in Select Novels of Shashi Deshpande. So historically speaking, patriarchy makes women undergo physical and psychological traumas right from their birth, right from the beginning. While a few women lose their lives, others survive the odd and demonstrate a great degree of resilience against inequalities and injustices occurring across the board or worldwide. So Shashi Deshpande, who is one of the most accomplished contemporary Indian writers in English, and her novels are actually one of the best example for this, where women are depicted as resilience against universally presumed asymmetrical, stereotypical patriarchal norms. So basically, my first part, so therefore my present research paper attempts to highlight the ideology of women's resilience in Shashi Deshpande select novels. So this paper can be divided into three parts. The first part is meant to highlight the persistence and resilience of women against universally presumed asymmetrical, stereotypical patriarchal system, accompanied by the ideas helped women maintain their resilience against unjust systems. And the second part provides a brief introduction to Shashi Deshpande and his position in Indian English literature. So the third part, that's the final part, highlights the narratives of resilience and representation of women in Shashi Deshpande's select novels. This paper is actually a conscious attempt to appreciate the resilience of women against the patriarchal game of power and pre-established discriminatory systems. So majorly, I have focused on the three novels named as The Dark Hole, No Terrors, That Long Silence, and Roots and Shadows. And these select novels represent the entire cult of womanhood without romanticizing or idealizing existing in Indian culture and literature, and the different types of relationships that women share in the wake of patriarchal consciousness. So the trauma of Indian women, their position in the family setup, and the compromises to the tradition has motivated me to pick out this title, From Resistance to Resilience, Feministic Development in Selected Novels of Shashi Deshpande. Thank you. That's all from my side, sir.
Okay, that was quite nice in the sense you kept the time very beautifully. And you spoke about three sessions. I have a couple of questions to you, actually. First thing, why did you select Shashi Deshpande of all writers? Because Shashi Deshpande is a much worked writer, and From Resistance to Resilience, that is a topic I think I myself have heard many people speak about. May not be in the same terms, but in different terms, of course. So how would you explain the choice of the topic, in the sense, how does your paper contribute something new to existing knowledge, existing body of research on Shashi Deshpande?
I'm doing PhD, so my topic is Voicing in Select Novels of Shashi Deshpande, Stories of Resistance, Resilience and Restraint. And all these three terms basically completely associated with Shashi Deshpande. I tried Chitra Banerjee, I tried Shashi Tharoor also, but these three terms, resistance, resilience and restraint, it's perfectly apt, perfect example goes with the Shashi Deshpande novels. Basically 5-6 novels.
Okay, that makes sense. So it is because you have taken it for PhD, and it is a great fortune that they approved the thesis, because Shashi Deshpande is much worked, and normally Viva boards have a lot of reservation approving topics on Shashi Deshpande. My second question concerns the second part of your paper. You said the second part is on Shashi Deshpande. Do you really think, as a researcher, because you're a research scholar, I'm asking, is it really important in a research paper to have a section on the author? Unless, of course, there are autobiographical elements or some historical importance attached to the events, why should we add a historical or an autobiographical about the author section to a paper? Because a paper is expected to be 2,000 or 3,000 words, and that is where we have to give our ideas, not give a biography of the author. It is done everywhere. People give a lot of biographical details just to fill the space. But do you think it is absolutely necessary to add that second part? Yeah.
Yeah, so basically this was a conscious attempt to appreciate the resilience of women against patriarchal norms and against patriarchal game of power and pre-established, you know, discriminatory system. So just to prove that, I have to represent the dialectics in all from the novels. So I have to represent this to prove that these are the actually attempts made by the protagonist.
Okay, that's fine. I'm asking because nobody else is asking any questions. I will take a back seat if somebody else asks. So that was a good presentation. You summarized your idea very well, and you didn't steal a lot of time. Though you were speaking about that long silence, your paper was also sandwiched between silence before and after. That was good. Okay, so thank you, Aishi. So we move to the next presentation. It is a presentation by Ms. R. Ahalya. She is a research scholar, and she will tell us about exploring the ancient Kerala with Appunni, a cultural probe into M.T. Vasudevan Nair's Nalukettu. Okay, Ahalya, are you here?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ahalya, a research scholar from Holy Cross College, Nagarkoil, and my title is Exploring the Ancient Kerala with Appunni, a Cultural Probe into M.T. Vasudevan Nair's Nalukettu. It's just a cultural probe into Nalukettu novel. And with this novel, as we all know, the culture, it refers to a belief or rituals or practices of a particular society or something. So I just, with this protagonist of the novel, that is Appunni, with him when we travel into the Kerala of the early period during 1980s or 1990s, so during those period, we can see the culture, they are entirely different from the present culture. So in a sense, the culture at present is different from those culture, and it is also happy to say that those culture they are not following entirely at present, because in this novel Nalikattu, he has talked about the subalternity in those period, and so most of the novel is about the negativity of the culture, and the women are not given any importance, and there is the caste system, and they follow the myth and rituals which are not much beneficial to the people. And so when we talk about it, the women, they are considered as a subalterns. Here the women are subalterns, even men are subalterns because of the caste system. See, they have the caste of people such as Mapilas, Cherumis, and they consider those people not even as a people, and they consider them lower than these people, even lower than the animals. So what they do is, if they have to walk near these Cherumis, they have to take bath after reaching the home. Only after that they have to enter into the house. These high class people, the people they are expected to be the Nayas, such peoples, they do such things. And the next thing what they do is they mostly don't have teas, and even if they have tea in the shops of Mapilas, that will be considered as a crime. Here Apuni, he is a son of a mother from a great Tharavad, and father, though he belongs to a Nayar community, he plays Pagida, and he is not a person who is ready to accept this caste system. He goes and have tea with in the shops of Mapilas. He'll talk to Cherumis, and so he is considered as a subaltern. And though she eloped, this Apuni, he faces a lot of troubles in the society. Though he belonged to a high caste, he faces a lot of troubles, and through his troubles we are coming to understand the culture of those society. And see, these women, they are considered even lower, and they don't have even the freedom to come out of their house through the main door if they are men of elder men of their family is in their front yard. So such things, and they have follows the myths such as they have the serpent tullal one thing, and it has been conducted because once a serpent it came to their house, and their myths belong to those things. They have to understand that if a serpent come to their house, there is some serpent living nearby their house, and they have to go in search of that. But instead they follow a thing called the serpent tullal, and they believe that that may reduce the coming of the serpent from there, that may stop the coming of the serpent into their house. So such things, those myths, these myths are not useful, because during the serpent tullal they are using the women as a tool. These women are not even given a proper clothing, etc. So their culture, that is very cruel culture in a sense, because it is full of negativity. Everyone are treated subalterns except those who are rich and those people who are considered as Nayas, and those other peoples, they are all considered to be very low. And this culture, only after reading this novel I came to understand that this cultural degradation is in a sense is very useful, because our culture, it is bound with all these rituals, and at present, due to modernization, we are not following such cultures. We are not ready to go for a serpent tullal with improper dress, and then we are ready to accept even the Cherumis as people. I hope at present we are accepting them. So according to me, this culture, when we look into the culture of our past, though it has changes in this modern period, it is there are positive changes even in the culture. And I also like to say that it is due to literature we came to know about this culture, and it is due to the novel, this novel Nalikattu, we have came to know about the culture of Kerala at those period. And I'm sure that at present the culture is different, and we are not following such culture. And with this, this is just a cultural probe into the novel. So with this, I'd like to conclude my presentation. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am, that was interesting. That was a cultural probe. And I was interested to know How did you read this book? Is it in translation? Because you are from Nagarkoil, Holy Cross.
Yeah, it's a translated novel. I read the translated version of Gita Krishnan Guti in English.
Okay. So how come you crossed the borders to Kerala and took a novel from... So because it is borders and borderlands. The seminar is about borders. So you crossed the borders and took a novel from Kerala. That is good. And did you feel like ever applying any cultural theory into this study? Because you have, yeah, basically it is a cultural probe, a historical study that you have done. But did you ever feel like applying any theory into analyzing this work?
Till then, I didn't feel to apply any theory on it. I just saw.
Yeah, I mean, for everyone, I guess, many of you are speaking about marginalization. One thing that we all can use, and this is something that I don't know why people are unaware of this, many such papers are coming. So we can use this theory of intersectionality where multiple, subordinations happen. You were saying that even men were subordinated.
Yeah.
So intersectionality theory when... multiple types of subordination, marginalization happens. You are a woman and then you are a third world woman and then you are a Muslim woman, that sort of multiple, that can be done. And maybe you could have also, as a further study, you could also look into the matrilineal dimension, because Nair society, the only matrilineal society, so maybe there is something else to look into as well. And so that was a very good presentation. It was, it opened a lot of eyes, I guess. And the eyes that are closed and the ears that are closed, please ask questions, because I want to tell you one thing. See, our organizers are giving the best paper presentation certificates to the first three, I guess. Best paper presentation awards are there. Keeping quiet during others' presentation is not the right way to get an award. So please ask questions and interact. Okay, so that was very good, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And the next presentation we will be having is by Aishwarya KS. She's a PG student and she is going to tell us about Black feminism and identity crisis in Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye, one of the most worked works in literature. Toni Morrison, Bluest Eye. PG students love Toni Morrison, I guess, and she died recently, but PG students do a lot of papers and even PG projects on this topic. So please go ahead. Thank you. Nice topic. Are you there? Aishwarya K.
Aishwarya K. Good afternoon, everyone. Hope that I am audible.
Yes, please go ahead.
Let me begin by thanking you for accepting my paper and giving an opportunity to present this evening. I am Aishwarya K. S. from Kerala. I am currently doing my post-graduation in English literature from Devamada College, Kuravilangad, Kottayam. This research paper is a part of my study. The title of my paper is Black Feminism and Identity Crisis in Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye. The reason I chosen this novel was because I got interested in it after reading a review. In this paper, I used to make an analysis of its characters in the light of the theories such as Black feminism, racism, identity crisis, and discrimination. Toni Morrison was one of the famous African writers for her examination of Black experience, especially the Black female experience within the Black community. The novel, The Bluest Eye, published in 1917, which is the first book of Morrison, deals with a victimized adolescent Black girl and her sufferings that she had to face from the whites. Through this novel, Morrison wanted to remind us how hurtful racism is. She was deeply concerned about the feelings of ugliness. Throughout this novel, the idea of ugliness is conveyed through the varieties of characters. Through all these thoughts, she wanted people to understand what it was like to be treated that way of ugliness. Actually, Morrison had her own bad experience being a black woman, and thus the novel reflects those sufferings. The events in the novel, The Bluest Eye, are not presented in chronologically, though it was divided into four seasons in an year, such as autumn, winter, spring, and summer. The story was portrayed through the voices and memories of two narrators. One is Claudia McTeer, a young black girl, and the other is the omniscient one. There are two families in the story. The protagonist, Pecola, belongs to the Breedlove's family, and there is the McTeer family, where one of the narrator, Claudia, belongs to. Pecola considered herself as ugly because of her race. She admires the whites and desires for blue eyes to being white. The character of Claudia hates white dolls. It symbolizes the complex love-hate relationship between the black and whites. Claudia defines black society's worship of white images as a complex self-hatred. Claudia uses the example of Shirley Temple to distinguish herself from Freida and Pecola and what they consider to be their inner racism. Shirley Temple is a young black girl, young white girl actress who have blue eyes, white skin and curly hair. Unlike Claudia, Pecola doesn't reject American white beauty standards, so she adores Shirley Temple and loves to play with white dolls. Pecola hated her ugliness. She wanted to have blue eyes and prayed for that. She thought that it would beautify her and turn all the evils of the life into good. There is an incident that happened to Pecola at the grocery shop. The store owner hesitated to take money from her hand, which made her sad and ashamed. Also, she found a picture of a beautiful girl with blue eyes on the candy wrapper. This forced her to believe more and more to the shame upon being ugly and priority of white beauty. Claudia, Ferida, and Pecola are disliked the light-skinned, wealthy black girl Maureen Peel. Boys used to harass Pecola about her black skin, but Maureen endures the boys pretend to be good. Though Maureen is a black girl, she also mocks Pecola. Pecola recognized that beauty means what we see from outside rather than what from inside. Coley, the father of Pecola, was racially humiliated several times. At first, when having sex with Darling, he was forced to do the act again by the command of the wives who entered there. So thus, it is evident that the racist stereotypes are there in the society. The feminist writer Bell Hooks says that black men may be victimized by racism, but sexism allows them to act as a oppressor or exploiter of women. Coley rapes his own daughter Pecola at the end of the story. Pecola becomes pregnant and the baby dies when born prematurely. Coley seems to blame the rape of his inability to express his feelings for Pecola in any other way. This incident shows that how women are physically inferior to men. Hooks continuously explained that feminism is a struggle to end sexist oppression. Pauline Breedlove, the mother of Pecola, considers beauty is white. She works for the whites. The characters in the novel, who are the working class African American, a group of people who struggles to survive. There is also the use of the word master refers the white and the relationship between the history of slavery. As an African American woman, Pauline constantly compares the lives of white women as she on her screen. Pauline represents the typical African black woman. The another character is Geraldine, is a black woman who is trying to imitate the white culture. She called Pecola as the nasty little black witch. It seems that all the female characters in the novel undergoes struggles and sufferings. At the end of the novel, Piccola goes mad and believing that her cherished wish has been fulfilled and that she has the bluest eye. The bluest eye launches a furious attack against white supremacy. In her novel, Morrison has expressed those ideas that a black person suffers from the white society. The novel therefore protests against colonialism and racism, reveals the struggle of women to strive and thrive. All human beings are to be considered as such, not by means of discriminating them by race. This is all about my research paper. Thank you all.
Okay, that was interesting. Bluest eye from a black feminist racist point of view. That was good. Was there a question? Somebody asked a question. Could you please check the chat and answer the question? Okay, who do you, Dasari Shashankar, yeah, Dasari asked, who do you think is the most sympathetic character in the novel and why?
Piccola is the sympathetic character in the novel because she always suffers the slavery, identity crisis, racism, black feminism, etc. And she, her father rapes her. And there is no a chance to live in that society with the white people.
Okay. Do you think colonialism is more in the mind than in mind or in the heart than in geography or in the physical space? Is it inside the mind or outside the mind, colonialism, regarding this particular novel?
Colonialism is inside the mind.
Okay. So, how can we so it should, do you say that we should have a decolonization of the heart? I think Franz Fanon wrote Decolonizing the Mind, right? Something like that can be done. That was interesting. Okay, Aishwarya, that was good. So, thank you. And the next paper presenter is A. Amala Nitya Roslin. She's a PhD research scholar and she has written a paper titled Strands of Jingoism in Purple Hibiscus by Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. Adichie's novel Purple Hibiscus, Strands of Jingoism. Okay, interesting. Are you there?
Hello.
Yes, yes.
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. So, I'm Amala Nitya Roslin from St. Xavier's College, Palayamkottai. And my paper is Strands of Jingoism in Purple Hibiscus by Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. Let me explain the title first. It is Strands of Jingoism. Jingoism is not exactly a theory, but it is like a concept. It refers to any extra patriarchal or extra suppression of ideology or insisting something forcibly on people. So it has some different shades of meanings also, not any particular concrete meaning for jingoism. And when we try to find the origin of this word, I found it was used first in American literature. And probably it was during the late 1980s, during the Crimean War, when there was the involvement of British America, Turkey and Russia. So this is the origin of the word jingoism. And as we all know that Adichie, she is a contemporary African writer, and Purple Hibiscus is her maiden novel. And here I try to highlight the jingoistic attitude, that is the patriarchal attitude of one particular character, that is Eugene. And I compared it with the colonial attitude. Eugene, he lived both in the colonial and post-colonial Nigeria. Most of his childhood was covered during the colonial period. So probably he had encountered many things with the missionary people, and he had complete colonial education from the missionary people. So he had an attraction towards Western language, Western attitude, and their standard of living, and probably their religion. So this is the main problems highlighted in the post-colonial issue, the conversion of religion, that is the transformation. As we all know that in Africa, they have so many tribal communities, and for them, there is always an aversion towards Christianity or any foreign religion that, before colonial period. And after the colonial period, many people, they started embracing a new religion, that is Christianity. And Eugene's one such character, he had a craze, he embraced Christianity with his all excitement, without knowing that his tribal community also has some value. So during this transformation, his attitude imitates like a typical Western attitude, and my paper attempted to highlight those attitudes with some of the incidents. It is from purple hibiscus. It is about the Palm Sunday event. It was with Jaja, his son, and then about the communion issues and abortion and many things. Gives each and every incident to show the Western attitude is a typical Nigerian, and that too from an ancient community. That is really, Eugene is from an Igbo community. So the experiments are as following. And she portrays the attainment of Jainism and Jainism at different levels in Purple Hibiscus. And another important thing is how this patriarchal attitude, that is the jingoistic attitude, visibly affect the people around them, that is, especially the family members. So it is cited in this paper. The very start of jingoism, it begins in house, and his children, Kamli and Jaja, are mentally and emotionally targeted by that. And the main questions arised in my paper is how colonial attitude, this is, he creates an import in a non-European people, the Kashi people's name, even after independence, even after a reasonable time after their return from colonial land, how their religion, language, and their attitude will affect the colonial people. And in Aunt Ifeoma, she is a sister of Eugene, and her life is completely contrast to what Eugene lives, and those experiences also given in this paper. And finally, what Adichie tries to portray is she expresses the controversial dispute between the minds of jingoists and a typical mainstream people in the Nigeria. She also try to express it in different ways, in different experience from different people, how a habitual mind around a jingoist is influenced, and also the amount of struggles the teenage mind faces, that is Kamli and Jaja. So it is the paper highlights the patriarchal profusion and the colonial and post-colonial experience of native Nigerian people, and how religion creates, that is, a foreign religion creates an impact in a non-European people's lifestyle, and how imitation of colonial attitude is happening still in the post-independent countries. So that's all it is about the paper. Thank you so much.
Okay, there is a question in the chat box. Could you please reply? Read the question and reply.
Okay, I couldn't find that.
Okay, I will read it for you. Don't worry. Surya R. asks, could you please tell why there was a craze towards Western attitude over the years? What are the factors that promote that craze?
I personally think it may be due to the Western education system, because in our education system also we have so many Western classics that always try to portray their system as very standardized form, and we people as some sort of ignorance towards standard. So it may be indirectly created some grace or excitement towards Western attitude. And another important thing is practicing or being Westernized is considered to be a standard form around the world. So we always try to imitate what Western people do. This is my personal opinion about Westernization or the excitement towards.
Do you think there is a different movement happening from the West to the East actually? People are moving, you know, the West is looking at the East for spiritual regeneration. Earlier it was like that. And even now we can see people are moving closer. For example, things like yoga. There is an exoticization, right? These things are being exoticized by the media, by the mainstream, you know, all these things exoticize those sort of things. So can we really say that it is always a movement towards the West now, or is there a counter movement setting in?
Yeah, probably every type of movement is happening. So before, during the colonial period, it may be due to any force or anything, people moved to another country, but now the movement and ideology, culture, everything has become fluid, and people are a little more open now, and they always create space to attract another any other culture or any other things apart from any stereotypical notions that was existed during the colonial period. And yes, there is the movement between Western people also attracted towards Indian culture, and probably that type of movement also happening nowadays.
Yeah, we speak about cultural exchange, right? Instead of one-sided procedures, we can speak about cultural exchanges. Linguistic exchanges happen, cultural exchanges happen. And you used a very good word, fluidity. There is a lot of fluidity in those things. So that's very good. So that is an interesting paper.
People became very flexible to accept any new ideologies nowadays.
Yeah, very true, very true, very good. So the next, thank you so much for that wonderful exposition. And the next paper is titled Deconstructing Ethical Meta-Narratives in George R.R. Martin's A Game of Thrones. It is written by Ambali Shashitharan Nair, a PhD research scholar. Okay, Deconstructing Ethical Meta-Narratives in Game of Thrones. Yes, please.
So are you able to see me right now?
Yeah, you are audible, okay. Visible. Please go ahead.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ambali S. Nair. I am a PhD research scholar from Rani Durgavati Vishwavidyalaya, Madhya Pradesh. My topic of research paper is Deconstructing Ethical Meta-Narratives in George R.R. Martin's A Game of Thrones. Ethics is one of the dominant meta-narratives that has been accepted blindly since the dawn of civilization. My paper mainly examines how this meta-narrative operates in the fictional medieval world of George R.R. Martin's novel, and it does this by showing tragic journeys of multiple characters enduring downfall due to their failed inability to reconcile their old ideologies with new perspectives. Ethical meta-narratives, such as concepts of good and evil, will be critiqued from the point of view of the postmodernist methodology of deconstruction, which is an effective instrument used for dismantling hierarchies within binary systems. It forces readers to critically examine centuries-old dogmatic beliefs through new glasses. The main findings of this research is showing how universalist tendencies of ethics should be frequently questioned in society if one is to avoid traps of injustice in the face of changing times. To begin with, definitions such as ethics is difficult to understand. It's an intricate concept to explain to, as it covers diverse connotations to each person who deals with it. In academic discipline, it denotes any system or theory of moral values or principles. In short, it can be understood as any morally correct or incorrect actions that individuals adopt to maximize their happiness and prosperity. However, most ethical meta-narratives never point out its source of authority. of view, this source can be founded on their personal experience that revolves around what is right and wrong. For others, it could emanate from their religious organization, their faith in governing law system, or the conventional norms accepted in society that predominantly describes how they outline their ethical values. Moral and social codes such as justice, chivalry, naivety, scrupulousness, valor, rightfulness are subjected to diverse interpretations, and yet several subsidiaries of these ethical meta-narratives are approved without much deliberation based on its universal appeal. For instance, any individual that carries virtuous traits such as honesty is often regarded with reverence, while those who lie and fall to the vice side are quickly condemned for their appalling decisions. This attitude to engage in extremes came because of modernism, whereby invariable principles such as good versus evil were usually delineated into distinct classes, and any contest regarding the blurred lines between them was treated as insignificant. Deviating from the principles of modernism therefore became paramount as the postmodernist era experienced an extreme loss in all types of ideological beliefs that they held prized until that time. Writers such as George R. R. Martin are ostensible about the growing disenchantment with modernist ethical idealisms that are strongly reflected in his novel A Game of Thrones that was written in 1996. Readers can perceive Martin's dissatisfaction towards moral prescriptions by showing characters undergoing tragic failures even if they acted scrupulous. If you have watched the TV series A Game of Thrones, you must be aware of the famous character Ned Stark, who is shown as one of the finest upstanding characters in the series, and yet because of his goodness also, he succumbs to his death due to his very virtues. Ned's romantic beliefs on morality are what led him to act merciful towards the queen, even when he was aware that her egocentric character and her overwhelming love for her children would push her to any extreme to defend them. He refused to observe the dangerous consequences of blindly following his idealistic tendencies and continued with his old ideologies of goodness without realizing the undercurrent realities of the era he was living in. However, the author does not establish that virtues are ineffectual and wickedness is the sole modus operandi through which to sustain one's place in today's corrupted world. Martin also shows how concepts of vice are equally problematic in today's society by showing lives of soldiers of the Night's Watch, Martin's fictional military order. In this subplot, the author reflects the journey of Ned's illegitimate son, Jon Snow, who joins the Night's Watch after being inspired by his uncle, but receives a rude awakening when he realizes the prestigious organization is no more respected. Instead, it is a dwindling force that functions as an exile colony for unwanted social outcasts like peasants, debtors, poachers, rapers, thieves alike. Nevertheless, it is this band of degenerates that prove their allegiance to the kingdom in the end by undergoing hunting missions to seize the looming assaults of the heinous zombie-like creatures called Others. Using grey characters like Jon's and the brothers of Night's Watch, Martin highlights the typical ethical deficiencies cannot be critiqued at face value to judge someone's merit, and instead encourages to develop more receptivity of such morally ambiguous traits. Questioning the authenticity of ethics is therefore important, be it idols of virtues or vice, so that such indisputable behaviors could be reviewed and properly deconstructed in time before its universalizing perceptions blind one from seeing the actuality of life. As observed through the examples in A Game of Thrones, deconstruction therefore poses a significant exercise in educating us on what happens when we believe in generalizing meta-narratives without reflecting on opposing binary groups that burgeon in society at the same time. Martin thus encourages readers to celebrate deviations in ethics as a part of natural occurrences and not pursue norms based on their universal sensibilities, but by accommodating realities of all kinds. That's all from my side. Thank you so much for listening.
Okay, well, that was a brilliant paper. It was very well written, very well presented as well. Meta-narratives in Game of Thrones and the deconstructive reading. Actually, I'm interested to know, you said he is supporting or encouraging deviant ways of thinking and all. what are those deviant things that he encourages? And is the binary between virtue and vice, or is it between straight or normal versus deviant? What is the binary that you are?
Mostly, he doesn't stick to one concept. There's a deviation in virtues and vices. There's a deviation on in terms of his structure also. He's a proper postmodernist writer in that way. He does not follow one path that's been, you know, followed by many writers. Like if you see Disney movies, there's always this knight who's good and he's handsome, and just because of his goodness he's able to conquer the world. So his characters are medieval characters, and they include a lot of knights and kings and queens, and they don't fit into one category of what is good and bad. They have a mix of personalities, and which is where the deviation comes. He shows their goodness, he shows their vice attitudes, their bad attitudes. And he does not say that just because you have a certain quality, that assures that you will have a happily good life, you know, that there will be cures, there will be disasters. Everyone has to go through the same kind of ups and downs in life. So that's what I really like about his book, where he does not camouflage the whole reality and, you know, spoon feed you a different kind of notion. He tells you the truth. This is going on in the world. This is how it happens. Let's not just celebrate one idea. Let's celebrate multiplicity.
That was nice. Thank you. Any other questions, people, participants? Please ask questions. Questions are a way of engaging the presenters and encouraging them. Encouraging everything. We need to do that because you know, paper presentation is the lifeline of research, and it is through paper presentations like this that we can learn a lot of things. So please be a little bit more interactive and ask questions, listen carefully and ask questions. Anyway, thank you for that paper. It was very illuminating, very good. The next presentation is by Anjali S. She's a faculty, the paper is titled Puppet Play of a Woman, a Character Study of Ponna of One Part Woman. Okay, I guess it is One Part Woman by Perumal Murugan, right? And I recently listened to a lecture on One Part Woman and its two sequels. So the multiple endings to One Part Woman. Is it Perumal Murugan? Yes?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
By
Perumal Murugan. Nice. Mm-hmm. Yes. Hello?
Hello, sir. Hello.
Yeah. Please continue.
Yeah. Okay. Good afternoon, all. Thank you for considering my paper for this presentation. So, paper as a woman, a character study of
Anjali. Excuse me. Your network
yes,
is this network doesn't seem to be good. Do one thing. Try to turn off your video and just focus on your audio. Maybe it will work.
Yes, sir. Okay. Now?
Yeah, please continue. Yeah.
Okay, I don't know what happened to my camera. Okay, I'm cutting. In this, what I have done is the character enough from Perumal Murugan. I'm familiar with this book. I'm going to a summary of the what
I think your audio is breaking the net. What do others feel? Is it my network that isn't working, or is it anything? Others, can you listen properly? Otherwise, we will just.
No, sir.
Yeah, so there is some problem. There is some network issue. Ma'am, you can make the presentation after a couple of presentations when the network gets better. For the time being, we tell me.
Let me connect to my Wi-Fi.
Yeah, try again. Yeah.
Just give me 1 second.
Yeah.
Hey, audible.
Please speak. I think it is breaking still. Please say something.
Sir, am I audible now?
Yeah, now it is better, it seems. Yeah, yes, continue.
So this is a character study of male characters, actually, on front woman. So, in society, especially an educated culturally bound,
no,
many
no,
in
please,
field, they are always marginalized.
We cannot hear anything. The network is very poor. Please join later. We shall postpone it for the time being. The next paper presented.
Yes, sir, okay.
Yeah, please join it. It will be good after some time. Okay, so is the next person ready? Anjali CT. She's a PG student. Please, the next people also be ready. If somebody is absent or if somebody's network issues, please be ready. Anjali CT. She's a PG student, and she is presenting a paper on women and political environments. A post-colonial eco-feminist reading of Thackeray's Chimney. Okay, the immortal work Chimney is being discussed. Okay, that is good. Okay, please continue.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm Anjali. I'm a postgraduate student in University College, Ottawa. My paper titled Women and Political Environments, a post-colonial eco-feminist reading of Thackeray's Chimney. Colonial feminism rests on the fact that feminism does not suffice for all the women of the world. Similarly, post-colonial criticism rests on the belief that typically African criticism is inadequate for the third world. So, what a colonial eco-feminism takes concern of post-colonial feminism and post-colonial criticism to establish that material conditions of the third world determine their relationship with the environment, while creating the advocacy of political feminism for the world. Post-colonial ecofeminism would match a analysis of women-nature relationship. A lack of difference in women and men's attitude towards nature and downtrodden societies do not make inferior societies. Women share their relation with the men of the society on the hands of the colonizer, as well as they get their due care of by the men of their own society. They are the colonized. So, this paper argues that this ecofeminism lacks the post-colonial purpose and fails to understand the material conditions of the women. This paper questions the advocacy of ecofeminism. So applies the alternative analysis that post-colonial ecofeminism tries to interpret the practices of the third world women, and that this particular text can be present. The textual analysis tries to show
Anjali, ma'am, would you please, sorry to interrupt, could you please turn off your video because the voice is breaking again.
Okay.
Try turning off your video.
Yeah. So I'm audible now.
Yeah, continue.
Yeah, okay. This is an analysis that post-feminism provides in the practice of third woman that this particular text present. So through this text analysis, I'm trying to show the practices of women and women their respective societies are determined by the material circumstances. The practices seen from an alternative analysis that helps understanding the relationship with the environment. The analysis defines the apparent harmful practices of women and men are not the result of internal oppression alone, but because of the social economic status that is determined by their status as post-colonized. Just as post-colonial eco-criticism arises out of a concern that mainstream and mental discourse is predominantly Western. Ecological feminism insists that the environmental discourse is male-centered. Subjecting the ancestric approach of environmentalism, ecofeminism rests on the belief that environment is a feminist issue. Now, ecofeminism was first used by French feminist Frances de Waal in her 1954 *Les Feminism or More*. It derives its work psychology and feminism, thus to refer to as psychological feminism. So feminists, on the other hand, incorporate feminist concepts of man or woman dualism and man or woman dualism, see an strategic approach at threat to environment and women. Women have always been associated with nature, and thus both have been suppressed by the male-centered society. So moving on to Chinmay, Malayalam novelist and short story writer Sagari Shivachandran Pilla, in her internationally acclaimed novel, presents a society that still works goddess and away from any kind of technological development. In the novel, he presents a community of fishers who live by the sea, away from any technological and industrial encroachment. Although the story is set in post-independence India, Kerala, on the southwest coast, it's early 1950s, there are no evident references to whether or not the characters in the story are affected by colonization. Living in extreme poverty, village characters are ruled and governed by tradition. The community's internal hierarchies based on caste system are the major cause of oppression of the lower caste. The strict caste system also provides logic of domination to the upper caste, since adhering to the system allows rich to maintain their richness while the poor can never escape their low status. This caste hierarchy is further maintained by myth and religion, where breaking the class boundary results in enraging the goddess of the sea. For these characters, gender is both unaffected by Western patriarchal structures and still salient to the lives of the people in the village. Pillai's lifelike characters have a desire to improve their life standards and fulfill their dreams. These desires and dreams are put in check by not allowing the low caste men to strive for a better future financially, and by restricting women to pursue their dreams. Religion, myth, and tradition are used as tools to keep poor men and women subdued. Men and women of the sea goddess worshipping community have ambivalent relationship with a goddess who regulates their lives. According to the myth, the goddess becomes enraged when the traditions of the community that are maintained for hundreds and hundreds of years are broken, for instance. For example, when a poor fisher buys a boat without the consent of the elites of the community, and when women become disloyal to their men to cause the currents in the sea, there are clearly certain groups then who can benefit from letting the myth survive, that is the elites community. In this regard, people's relationship with a goddess that represents nature is based on cultural values that support patriarchy and class barriers. Those who challenge these values, as the central characters of the novel do, are in clash with the goddess representing the forces of nature. The list is depiction of a goddess worshipping community that connects women with nature and nature with women is apparently an ideal society for spiritual ecofeminists like Vandana Shiva, who believes that such society neither devalue women nor they devalue nature. Pillai shows that both the myth and tradition, one way or the other, oppress women. Pillai's depiction of ambivalent relationship of various characters with their natural environment reflects his understanding that these relationships are outcome of characters' material conditions. Those who bring the wrath of godness of the sea are either economically forced to challenge the myth and tradition or forced to rise against the oppression based on gender. Women are also symbolically and spiritually connected to nature in Pillai's depicted society. The material conditions depict them as powerless and continuously in the state of struggle. Their spiritual connection with the nature shows their extreme power. Women-nature connection and the oppression of both at the hands of men don't escape Pillai. Men, referred to as the sons of the sea, have a typical patriarchal relationship with the sea and the goddess, as men have towards women. They depend on the sea and women, yet they deny their dependence on both. Although Pillai's presented society is not an ideal society for spiritual ecofeminists who would want women to have power, it does not present nature connection in more than one way that show post-colonial ecofeminist traits in his works. Besides spiritual women-nature connection, Pillai also shows that women-nature connection that sanctions the twin oppression at the hands of patriarchy. Men presented society take help from their women in their day-to-day activities, but women's activities just background to men's major tasks. They never acknowledge the support they receive from women, just as the men use the natural resources from the sea without caring for the sea life. Both women's services and natural resources are used as commodities that are exploited to the fullest by men. Women's closeness to nature as a result of their socialization as nurturers and caretakers does not empower them, as this closeness and association is used to inferiorize both women and nature. Vandana Shiva claims that women in the third world have a stronger connection with nature. The oppression of nature is directly linked to the oppression and marginalization of women. She believes that women produce and reproduce life not merely biologically, but also through their social role in providing sustenance. Ecofeminism acknowledges that women are not inferior in every society, and that they are conditioned to work under patriarchal values. Once they challenge the patriarchal values, they can bring about the desired change. Postcolonial ecofeminism, on the other hand, not only acknowledges the inferior status of women and patriarchal condition, but also the status both men and women as post-colonized in the third world downtrodden society. As a result, activism of women and even men most of the time are determined by the environment in which they work. In the post-colonial society, this internal hierarchy maintained by patriarchy, there are other hierarchies too. This embedded in our journalism. As Plumbo contends, we prioritize reason over emotion, mind over body, and culture over nature, and so on. As a result, this reason, mind, and culture are superior and related to men. Emotion, body, and nature, on the other hand, are inferior and related to them. So, in patriarchal society, everything that is considered superior as male and everything that's considered inferior as female. For post-colonial society, this civilization is more complex. Post-colonial society, in its entirety, includes male and female, human and non-human, is inferiorized, feminized, and naturalized by colonial power. Play out the roles of two levels. One, a symbolic and spiritual. They are regarded as guardians of the men on the sea. When a woman is married, it is not she who is being entrusted to the man, but the contrary, man entrusted to a woman. Because the lives of the sea are in the hands of women on the ship who pray for the safety of men. The story of women plays a huge role in this novel. In this regard, survival of a fisherman depends on the purity of his wife. A woman is not the defiled that brings the anger of goddess of the sea, and she would destroy everything. Woman is such old extreme power as she can
please,
be a maker.
Please maintain time. Please wind up.
Woman is such a role extreme power as she can be a maker, a destroyer of not only her friends but also of the entire community. Apart from that, that she holds because of her relationship, the goddess of the sea is connected to the actual material conditions of life. For the material world is a territory of Earth. In Chimmin, there is no clear-cut dichotomy between men and women regarding their relationship with their natural environment. Both have ambivalent relationships with nature. However, the only person showing compassion for environment is the big character of Palani. When Kartana has wife advice to save money, buy a boat and a stone, he explains that all the fish on the seacoast like that, the whole seacoast would be full of melons. This is because he makes money at the cost of millions of them. He makes his money by cheating, catching innocent beings moving freely in the sea. To look upon those millions lying with their eyes open was nothing to those those so at sight every day. The gradual domination of females is their male identity simultaneously led to the domination of women and nature, which men started using according to their beliefs to consequences patriarchal society would have to face.
Please wind up, please wind up. You are taking a lot of time. We don't have, a lot of people are waiting. Please wind up.
In order to shatter this, it is important to consider all forms of oppression as liberation. One or the other is not the solution of the problem. That's the end of my paper. Thank you.
Okay, there was a lot of network problems, so we couldn't, we missed a lot of your presentation in between.
Sir?
Yes?
Yes. Speak, sir. I'll, once you complete, I'll tell you.
Okay. So that was a paper on Chemmin, a postcolonial ecofeminist reading. That was nice. Yes, Mahesh, please go on. Thank you for the presentation, ma'am. We'll move to the next one. Mahesh.
Sir, how many did we complete, sir?
We are now the 10th person has presented, but one person could not complete because of network issue. 9th paper, Anjali S. could not make the presentation because of network problem.
Many are facing network issues, sir.
Yeah.
What shall we do, sir?
Well, I don't know what to do. Let us see how the network is. Anjima Benny, PG student, she's the next to make the presentation. Why don't we have any men? Is it all women? There is a lot of all women begin with
not pre-planned. Not pre-planned.
Okay.
Comes as per alphabetical.
Okay.
Sir, I would like to tell you that we will complete till 17, and tomorrow it's an announcement to all of you. Okay. It's an announcement to all the participants. That till 17 we'll complete today, and the other for the other people we will conduct parallel sessions by tomorrow afternoon.
Okay, Mahesh, maybe we have to conduct morning session also, because evening session, even with parallel session, there will be lot of people. No.
Okay, we'll plan.
Yeah. We will inform them, right?
Yes. We'll inform once our session is over.
Okay. Anjima Benny, she is going to speak on subaltern tempests, subverting the canon to voice the margins. Subaltern tempests, subverting the canon to voice the margins. Yes. Yeah. Welcome. Please.
Good afternoon, one and all. I'm Anjima P. Benny, first year MA English student from St. Peter's College, Colonnery. I'm here to present my paper titled Subaltern Tempest, Subverting Canon Towards the Margins. Subaltern is not just a classy word for oppressed, for somebody who's not getting a piece of the pie. In post-colonial terms, everything that has limited or no access to the cultural imperialism is subaltern, a space of difference. This paper, with reference to Gayatri Chakravarti, is can subaltern speak, Saman Thama Sankati, which can be best described as a personal observation of the author who has highlighted the struggles of paria women in the marginalized male chauvinist Dalit society. Thama is a Dalit feminist and novelist born in Pudupati village in Tamil Nadu. She is the leading voice of the suppressed class Dalits who penned only for the deprived class, who she thinks that it's her duty to voice her people's plight to the society. Sankati, originally written in 1994 as a narrative articulating the Dalit mind, the opening chapters is narrated in the first person, then counterpointed by the generalizing comments of grandmother and other mother figures, and later still by the other narrator's reflections. There are more than 35 characters, most of them are females, but in conventional sense, there is no individual who could be tagged as a hero or heroine. The novel deals with gender bias, sexual assault, customs, practices, beliefs, and so on that run through the marginalized Dalit community. The novel deals with gender bias faced by Dalit women right from the beginning of their childhood. Bhama explains that games were also gender-based. While games like kabaddi and marbles were meant for boys, girls played games like cooking, getting married, and other domestic matters. The story of narrator's cousin Mariamma tells a lot about the sexual assault, the abuse faced by Dalit women, and their inability to stand up against it. Bhama's language is also very different from other Indian women writers. She addresses the women of village by using suffix amma with their names. The text is plentifully filled with uncouth language and abuses made on one another, and shows the violence and irritability that the women of the Dalit community undergo. The post-colonial area of her book is in its huge criticism of the Indian church. Bhama is a critic of casteism within the church and church rules. The author's party, Velemma, tells the narrator that pails do not have feet and that nothing should be spoke loud after dark. Such stories not only reveal the popular superstitions and cultural beliefs of people in a region, but also show gender discrimination. Sangathi is not just an autobiography, but a personal statement of an individual in segregation. Bhama and Sangathi shows the ability of the Dalit women to think and rethink and analyze situation for themselves. They are independent subjects in the process of realizing their value in society. The narrator of this novel finally becomes free from the tight hold of her limitations. She works and lives by herself. The theme of Sankalpi is from subjugation to celebration. Bhama doesn't portray a case of white men saving brown women from brown men, but rather one of brown women saving themselves from brown men. And in doing so, it builds up the consciousness of Dalit women to tackle the ready-made stereotypes. Bhama calls men in her community to speak for themselves, because only the one who had experienced lifelong torments can give a best explanation about what they had gone through. I would like to conclude my words by saying that I strongly believe that one must never accept somebody's definition for your life. Define yourself. Thank you.
Okay, that was a very good paper. It was clear, and I have a couple of questions for you. Since nobody else has questions, I will ask a couple of questions. One, regarding the language used by Bhama in her writings. So people who are against subaltern writings, they generally make the statement that subaltern literature is unaesthetic. It doesn't follow artistic value. Its language is unaesthetic. It uses slang. You were referring to certain uses of language by Bhama in her Sangathi, right? So how do you look at that particular accusation made by the critics of subaltern literature, that it is unaesthetic, it is not artistic? How do you look at it? How would you defend Bhama from that criticism?
Whenever we go through a torment, it can be best explained in our own mother tongue, in our own language. So I think she made a great choice. She did it in a simple language. She done it in Tamil.
Yeah.
That's her mother tongue.
Yeah, that's her mother tongue. And the way she writes, so the idea is the way normally people, Bhama herself defends this, saying that, what is art? Art exists not in revealing art, but in concealing art. And what is, the traditional definition of art? Art is a mirror held up to life, a reflection of life. And if this is the language of life, that the kind of explanation that Dr. Johnson would have given. If this is life, and if this is the language used in real life, then if literature is a reflection of life, it should have this real language. That could be one way of explaining it. And another thing, I had a second question. I think I have forgotten it for your sake. Okay, so what is this subaltern tempests in the title? What does the tempest refer to?
Subaltern tempest means tempest means a violent windy storm.
Okay.
So she's trying to shake those things, that upper caste domination and all.
Okay, so you have used it in a metaphoric sense, right? The
Yeah, yes, sir.
okay. I think there was a question in the chat box as well. Will there be, okay, that is a question to me. Will there be a second session? In the list, yeah, in the list there are two sessions and 34 people, but Mahesh Raja, the organizer, he just stated that the first session alone will be completed today. I mean, if somebody is wants to make the presentation today itself, I mean, I can wait for a few more papers as well. I'm tired, you know, I was giving the lecture, but yeah, we can make a few more presentations if somebody urgently wants to make the presentation today. Otherwise, he said we will have the presentation tomorrow. Now, the timing will be given later. And please clarify, what was the question? Subaltern literature also attempts to redefine aesthetics as well. Okay, yeah. Yes, Anna Georgia, that is spot on. That is a very relevant observation. It redefines aesthetics. It redefines aesthetics. Yeah, very good. It is an attempt to redefine aesthetics, and people like Sharon Kumar Limbale, his language, Bama, very good example. Their language is, you know, is an attempt to subvert the traditional views on aesthetics. They're very good. Okay, so Anjima, that was a very good paper. Good. Okay, yeah, yeah, we will consider Rodrigo. Yes, we will. Okay, so the next presentation is by Anna George. She's a PhD scholar, and oh, she is going to speak on Kanaki and the changing concepts of femininity. Wonderful topic, Kanaki. Yes, please. Anna George, are you here?
Yeah. Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Hello, everybody. First of all, thank you for letting me present in this conference. And am I audible?
Yes, yes, please continue.
Okay, so my paper. The argument basically in my paper is about how over the decades we have seen many attempts, many organizations which promote equality of women, you know, discuss about voting rights, educational rights, etc. But even in those attempts, patriarchy manages to seep in and seep in, and hence it needs a, you know, constant updation in a way so that it can stay relevant. And I would say Kannaki, the protagonist of Chilapathikaram, is often used in such a way that she almost portrays this very submissive, self-effacing female that is encouraged by the patriarchal system. Though she can be a much more significant literary figure. So I'm sure everybody here is familiar with the story of Chilapathikaram and the story of Kannaki, but still I would like to say it in a few lines. Kannaki and Kovilan were husband and, you know, they were a couple, they got married, but yeah, Kovilan apparently fell in love with a courtesan, Madhavi, and ignored Kannaki for a long while, but after a while he returned to Kannaki and he was penniless, and so they traveled to Madurai where he gets accused of theft and is beheaded. So Kannaki, as a revenge for this, she proves the innocence of her husband and then burns the entire city of Madurai. So and then later she is worshipped as goddess Patni in she ascends to heaven, and later she is worshipped as goddess Patni. Okay, this is the story of Chilapathikaram written by Ilangovodigal. Now, how did this story become popular is also another question. Sangam literature and even post-Sangam literature like that of Chilapathikaram has its roots in the folk literature. When I say folk, I mean the literature that is not officially published or, you know, written down and passed, but instead the songs that are sung and passed down from generation to generation. So Sangam literature has that root in it, and according to many scholars like George L. Hart, and so does Chilapathikaram. So the popular Tamil, popular South Indian society got to know about, you know, became more aware about Chilapathikaram when it was translated, along with many other texts. It was translated in 1890s by U.B. Swaminathayyar. Then this this plot of Chilapathikaram became so famous, it became adapted, got adapted into movies at least 4 or 5 times, even in, you know, even as silent movies. It became very popular dramas, Koval and Kadai, Kannagi Kadai, it was popular, became so popular, it had, you know, it had a great run in Kerala and Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. And today, you know, even today, we have the presence of Kannagi is, let's say, it's something that cannot be ignored. Like, you can see her statues in the Marina Beach, in the DMK offices, etc. So this is the Kannagi that we know as of now. Even in textbooks, you can see Kannagi. You know, in Tamil Nadu State Board syllabus textbooks, you can see the presence of Kannagi. Now, how does this person's, this Kannagi that we have constituted through, you know, the Kannagi that we have familiarized ourselves to the 20th century, how does she influence the modern South Indian, modern Tamil women? Let's think about that. So, the state-wise identities, what I mean that we have today, the modern Malayali, the modern Tamil, the modern Indian identity, it's something that is of recent creation. And linguistic politics was very strong, linguistic pride was very strong in South India. So apparently, Tamil language became a very important point of debate. And Tamil language was called Tamil Thai, Tamil Mother. And interestingly, I've seen this reference by Jacob Pandian. He says that why Kannagi is important and how it coincides with Tamil Thai is just the way we are familiar that Tamil versus Hindi was a huge, was a landmark political incident in the national politics. So he says that just the way Kannagi is pure and chaste, so should be Tamil, our mother. So Tamil, our mother, right now has influences from English, from Hindi, from Sanskrit. So they should be removed and made as pure as Kannagi, the epic heroine Kannagi. So that sort of parallel, like, you know, the mother who should be pure, the mother who should be chaste, and as chaste as Kannagi, became something told over and over. Like, I have read Chilapathikaram, and in Chilapathikaram, you don't see the term of karpa quite often. But if you go today and look at the statue of Kannagi, you can see that it's written karpa karasi Kannagi. Or queen of karpa is a complex term, I would say. It means chastity, virginity, loyalty to your husband, everything melted together. And there, it's the translation of it is written as perfection of chastity in on the statue. So, in the movie versions, even in Malayalam movie versions of Malayalam or Tamil movie versions, Madhavi is shown as the villain character, you know, seductress. But that's not how she is written in the poem. While, you know, in the popular narrative, she becomes the Kama Kirati, you know, the lustful seductress who wanted to, you know, who has this unsatiable lust for money, for men, and something that cannot be quenched at all. But she is a courtesan, not a prostitute. But that difference had almost zeroed out when it came to the 20th century India. So, and again, when it comes, let's go back to the creation of modern Tamil women, how that was created. Definitely, when we think about feminist movements in South India, one name that we cannot forget is that of Periyar E.V. Ramaswamy. So, Periyar's Suyamariyadai Iyakam has done some great contributions. He has thought way forward, I mean, much ahead of its times when it comes to women's rights. But one of his followers, one of the members of Suyamariyadai Iyakam, Achalambikari, she knew English and Tamil, but she, in an essay, writes that women shouldn't learn any language other than Tamil. They shouldn't learn English. because then they wouldn't be ideal Tamil housewives, ideal Tamil mothers or wives. So this is a lady who has learned English. But yeah, so what, this is not something that you can see in just one person, like be it Raja Ram Mohan Roy or Russo. You can, they say that education for men and women should be separate, so that, you know, they, men can be men and women can be women. So rather than having education for, you know, for being more empowered, for having more agency and power, this is about making you into, making you know, making you shift, fit into some model that is, let's say, more convenient. So, and then in another work called Muppin Manigal Varalatre by Neelambika Ammayar, she says, she refers to certain verbs like Alli, Arasan Kovai, and says that these are works that are to be read at night. But women don't read it even at night, because these can corrupt women way too much. So when I read this, I was reminded of Tess D'Urberville. You know, Tess D'Urberville, she says, and after she's seduced, unfortunately seduced by Alec D'Urberville, a rich man, she complains to her mother, saying that, Mom, why didn't you tell me about the evil ways of men? The men have, I mean, upper class women have novels to explain all that to them. But I'm an uneducated woman, how would I know? So, and when novels were, you know, when it comes to novels, even novels were forbidden for reading, for, you know, forbidden for women, because they were, you know, they would corrupt the morality of women. So, similar, I mean, that sort of sentiments can be seen in a progressive progressive organization like Suyamariyadhi Iyakam as well. So I'm not saying everybody, I'm not, you know, tarnishing an entire organization, but like I said, there are a few examples like these. And let's even, you know, in Tilapathi Garam, you find her becoming the Patini Deva, the wife goddess. She's an ideal wife, supposedly. But the association of Katpa to Kandaki, something that happened relatively more recently. And when it comes to Tamil women, again, another example I'd like to quote is that of Rukmini Devi Arundhati. So, you know, she is quite famous because she popularized Bharatanatyam. Actually, she, I would say she conceptualized Bharatanatyam.
Okay. Could but you please wind up, because the time...
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll be finishing in 2 minutes. Yeah. So she conceptualized Bharatanatyam, but a lot of practitioners of Bharatanatyam then and now, they often complain that she removed all the erotic nature from the, all the eroticized nature, or from the, you know, from the art of Satiratam, and made it into Bharatanatyam. And she says the reason she did that was because she wanted an art form that can be Indian, that can be viewed by all audience, that's not, you know, that wouldn't show the, let's say, the more the more savage nature of Indian arts, because that's how the West always looked at Indian arts. You know, they're savage, they're less cultured. So, you know, let's show it into a much more, in a much better way. You know, so, and dancers by that time almost became equivalent to prostitutes. Courtesans became equivalent to prostitutes. So she wanted to remove all that, but there were a lot of dancers who said that this is this was something problematic, because this is actually removing the entire essence of Satiratam when it became Bharatanatyam. So again, this also is a proof that how Indian woman should be, the concept of Indian woman was not as modern as it intended to be. So I'm definitely, but Kannaki did not go uncriticized any day. Periyar has famously criticized Tilapathi Garam, saying that it is a text that undermines women terribly. Like, if Kannaki had any self-respect, she would not have welcomed her husband back into her life. And another writer like Subramanya Swamiyar was very much opposite and, you know, opposed strongly the installation of the statue of Kannaki, the movies made about Kannaki. Now, and the major point I'd like to say is the Muduvan caste of Kerala, they were, yes, I will be, oh, it'll be over, so, yep, in 2 minutes. Okay. the Muduvan caste in Kerala.
No more 2 minutes, please. We have already exceeded a lot of time. Please wind up. Please wind up.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Okay. The Muduvan caste in Kerala, they consider themselves the descendants of Kannaki, and they say she was the one who taught them to live peacefully. You know, they came with her to the mountains, and there, you know, she taught her to live with the forest in unity. And so we see another much bolder version of Kannaki in the totem part that we can see in southern Kerala. So, unfortunately, these stories, like the stories of Muduvans, the stories we can see in totem part, so are not seen in the, when we look about Kannaki. These stories are not made into movies. These stories are not made into Amar Chitragathas or into textbooks. So, I would say by including these subaltern narratives as about Kannaki as well, the narrative of Kannaki in itself will stay more relevant. Otherwise, it will just become, you know, it will be something used as, you know, Kannaki will just become something, a tale that was used to propagate the patriarchal concept of, you know, how women should be self-effacing, always forgiving, and the ideal Patibrata who would tolerate anything. But instead, if we include these two, we can have a much sustaining narrative, and that would that would be much more healthier and inclusive. Thank you.
Okay, that was an excellent paper, very seductive. I was seduced to listen to it more, but time constraints. I think if you could share this paper somewhere, we could all read it. It's a very good study. Excellent research has gone into it, and I have a lot of questions, but I am going to ask none or maybe one. How do you look at Chilappu, the anklet? How has the anklet changed when versions of feminism has changed? Has it changed as a symbol?
Yeah, definitely, sir. So, like, one of the recent dialogues I heard was that you won't know whether your anklet is a chain unless you try to move forward. So whether it's an anklet or whether it is something that is just kept there to bind you. So, when I was little, we all used to, I'm sure every other girl child would be around here would be familiar, South India would be familiar, you know, there are these anklets with bells that almost, you know, that will sound everywhere you go. So this was more or less like an alarm, like if the child wanders, we just need to listen where they sound, to know where they have gone. So definitely anklet is an ornament, and in this case anklet was and a source of investment in Chilapathigar. Kannaki gives it to her husband because, you know, let's give it as a capital to start his new venture. And that idea is still there. You know, women have gold, and women gets gold, and having women with gold during a dowry is valued much more, mainly, maybe because of this investment idea along
So you have to move forward to know whether it is an anklet or a chain.
Yeah, definitely.
We will speak about it later if we meet somewhere. Study. Thank you so much. Because of time constraints, we are moving forward. Yes, Mahesh?
Yes, sir. People are asking me questions.
People are asking a lot of questions, Mahesh. What? Help me. I don't want to deny anyone, but then what about the time and all?
How many did we complete now?
We are on the 12th paper, I think. 12th or 13th? 12th. I will stretch my maximum. I'm seeing the messages in the chat box. Can I? But I don't know where, what. Mahesh, you may take a decision. From the second
decision.
Second session two. Add five more participants to this session. Some people want to present it today itself. So those who asked first, there should be some criteria. Otherwise,
okay. The first come, first serve.
Yeah, so you can check the chat box and whoever messaged first, those five people we will have from the second session. And others, please bear with us, because I was not originally meant to chair this session either, but because Pauline ma'am could not join, I am chairing after the lecture, so getting tired also. So please bear with us, but please don't leave because your presentation is not here, because we are learning. I am interested in learning because I saw some very good papers being presented and I could learn a lot of things. So have that interest in learning, other participants as well. If possible, stay. And so that is it. We will complete this five.
One small announcement I'll make and then I'll leave.
I'll hand over
the session to you. The announcement is for the parallel session, the schedule will be mailed to you, as well as it will be, the schedule will be sent in the WhatsApp groups. So kindly bear with us. Tomorrow it will not be 17:17. The number may change. Yes, the number will definitely get changed. We'll send you the. We will definitely say mail you, as I said. We'll WhatsApp you also. So that's it. That's the notification. Thank you.
And Mahesh, please decide who are the five. Please tell them, because I don't know who all messaged from the second session.
Kamala Bharati ma'am, are you here?
No, yes, sir.
Just to follow the criteria, ma'am. First come, first serve. Just choose the first five who showed their wish to present.
It is Jobrit Rodrigo is there. He was the first one. That's it.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, Jobrit Rodrigo, Deepthi Menon. Then Kartika MK.
Kartika, yes.
Jomedi Bernardin and Farhan Ali. Can we have this many people, right? Is it fine?
Yes.
Okay, sir. Farhan Ali. I think the person did not send paper or full paper. How can we allow?
There should be the full.
Is the name there in the list?
If these people are there in the list, I will allow. Yeah.
Yes, sir. And I request all the participants to finish at least before 6 or 7 minutes. when we go over 10 minutes, the chairperson will get tired. As well as we will lose our, others will also lose their internet connections. There are lots of issues. That's why I'm asking you to find it.
Subalternity is also about patience, Mahesh. Okay. We will complete the first session and the other five whom I mentioned right now, right?
Okay, sir.
If they have submitted the requirements, if they have completed the requirements, they will be allowed to present. Yes. So next is, who is the next person?
Kamala Bharati ma'am, check the list. Check our checklist
ma'am,
and tell.
Please listen what we are saying. You are asking so many questions. Please listen. I have already explained 2-3 times. Please listen and okay. So your session will be tomorrow only. So now we have Adijit Ghosh, guest lecturer, and he is going to present a paper on subaltern subjectivities in the corpus of diasporic literature, a study of Amitav Ghosh's The Circle of Reason and V.S. Naipaul's A Bend in the River. A huge topic worth a PhD. Yeah, go ahead. Adijit, yes.
Yes. Oh, sir, am I audible?
Sorry,
am I audible?
Addressing you by name. You're a senior person.
No. Yes.
Yes, sir.
It doesn't matter, sir. Okay. Sir, am I audible and visible?
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Yes. Okay. Good evening to one and all present in this online conference today. And we don't have much time today, so I've decided to just, you know, touch upon the basic tenets of my paper. As you know, Manu sir has just said, the title of my paper is Subaltern Subjectivities in the Corpus of Diasporic Literature, a study of Amitabh Ghosh's The Circle of Reason and V.S. Naipaul's A Bend in the River. And to start things off, let me just say a few things regarding subaltern and diaspora. And as we all know, that the word subaltern was first used by the Italian Marxist thinker Antonio Gramsci in a way to be able to express his views on the hegemonic dominance of the ruling classes over the subordinate masses in the previous two centuries. And later, it was in the 1980s that the term gained popularity with its extensive use by the subaltern studies group, you know, formed by Ranajit Guha. Now, the discipline of subaltern studies came up as a separate subject of study that seeks to analyze the binary relationship of the subaltern people and the ruling class, taking into account the interplay of dominance and subordination in colonial systems, the narratives of which went undocumented for several reasons. Therefore, the fractured identity and consciousness of the subaltern class in India basically represents the fragments of a colonized nation that was under the domination of the colonial power for a long period of time. And having said that, let me just move on to the essence of diasporic literature, which works within the framework of the post-colonialism as it takes into account several issues like marginalization, cultural oppression, racism, social inequality, dislocation, and trauma faced by the diasporic people in the foreign land. So this, you know, diasporic writing basically, you know, deals with the two invariables, you know, of their experiences, namely exile and homeland. And naturally, the writings of the immigrant diasporic writers are characterized by a vacillation between a temporal and spatial space, as if they were, you know, writing in search of a homeland, as home remains a mystic place of desire in the diasporic imagination. Now, I have chosen two novels, you know, and the first novel is The Circle of Reason by Amitabh Ghosh, and this is his first novel, as we all know. And this novel is a brilliant piece of experimentation with its form, content, and language. And it also bears the hallmark of being a travel narrative interspersed by episodes that are steeped in historical, mythological, and scientific elements. And apart from all these factors, his novel can also be judged from the perspective of you know, diasporic literature, the essence of which is also marked by the subaltern subjectivities of the protagonist Alu. And the name, as I just, you know, named the, you know, as I just uttered the name of the protagonist Alu, this is basically a Bengali word, and the English of which is potato, and basically this has been a ploy of Ghosh, you know, to employ such a name, you know, in order to point out to the after effect of the European colonization, as a result of which cultivation of potatoes started in India at the dawn of the 17th century, right? And at the same time, the word Alu basically, you know, has another connotation in it, that, you know, it also means, you know, finding for the roots, which in turn can be associated with the tenet of diasporic consciousness. And, you know, this novel has three parts. The first part, the name of the first part is, just a minute. The first part of the novel actually tells us about a sort of a bomb explosion in the village of Lalpukur, in the incident of which Alu was falsely accused of being a terrorist. He flees his village after he survives the explosion and finds his way through Calcutta to Goa first, and boards a trawler that takes him through the Persian Gulf to Al Ghazira in North Africa. And this is what you can, you know, this can be, you know, said to be an attempt on the part of the author to merge boundaries, you know, and connect to continents with a deep ethos of diasporic sentiments, right? And one more thing I would like to, you know, add in this respect is, you know, how Ghosh has particularly brought in the theme of, or the activity of weaving, and presented it in the backdrop of a sort of a diasporic, you know, activity, right? And the weaving actually secures a prominent place in the whole of the novel, as it stands against the scientific reason promulgated by the Western thoughts. And the despair and rootlessness that comes along with the diasporic feeling is also, you know, visible in the other characters of the novel, like, you know, Zindi, Kulfi. And we also come across various situations in which they not only undergo, you know, different sorts of trials and tribulations, but also testify to the very, testify to the very ethos of the diasporic sentiments that Ghosh has tried to portray in his first novel. And, you know, after a loss of, you know, hardship, Alu starts another journey through the travels of his misfortune by escaping Al Ghazira and arriving in Al Qued in the Algerian Sahara. And here we find another, you know, diasporic character, Dr. Varma, who spares some time with the small community of immigrants, you know, present over there in order to keep up the Indian traditions alive among them. And there is a complete transformation of Alu that we can see in the last chapter of the book, that is, you know, named as Tamas or Death, you know, and that comes with the death of Kulfi, you know, and the death of the degenerated Swatta. And we basically remain a witness to the transformation of reason itself through the cycle of death. And basically, Alu with his altered Swatta gets united with his diasporic soul at the end of the novel, who longs for returning to the space from where the journey of the narrative started, implying his diasporic penchant from home and obviously making it a complete circle, as the name of the title, you know, is, you know, suggests. Now, let me move on to the next part of my, you know, paper that focuses on the diasporic elements in V.S. Naipaul's A Bend in the River. Basically, this...
Could you please summarize it?
Yes. Just 2 minutes, sir. Yes. The novel, this is a, you know, this records the traumatic experiences of the diasporic communities, you know, based in a country, Zaire, now which falls under the aegis of the Democratic Republic of Congo in Africa. And in this novel, basically, we discover the rootlessness, dislocation and trauma from the perspective of a subaltern subjectivity in a post-colonial world like Africa, and that too from the character of Salim, as he, serves to be the mouthpiece of Naipaul. And, he faces different sorts of crises as we move on through the novel. He suffers from a sense of cultural identity, which is basically, you know, brought on by the curse of colonialism. He develops a sort of ennui towards African culture and remains totally detached from it. You know, this detachment gradually confines him to his own space, which not only makes him aloof from his family and the community he belongs to, but also testifies to the ethos of diasporic feeling. And last but not the least is the thing is, as we move on, we find how Salim splits the African world, each of which is characterized by its polarities. You know, the first world replicates the life that Salim shares with other expatriates like Meti, Shobha and Mahesh in a shabby town. And they are altogether isolated from the other half of the country, which represented the life in the domain. And their world is the only place which brings out their subaltern subjectivities against the backdrop of a diasporic paradigm. And this dichotomy between, you know, these two worlds over which we find Salim to ruminate is established on a binary opposition between a theorized version of Africa represented by the so-called colonial and bourgeois nationalist elites, and another Africa which speaks of the reality of everyday life and is epitomized by the subaltern and diasporic group of people represented by Salim. So that's all about me, about my paper. And if you are having any sort of questions, you feel free to write it up in the chat box. And I think, you know, Manu sir will also agree with me on this point.
Exactly. Sir, I was very happy for one thing.
Yes.
For the first time after so many years, I got the nostalgic feeling of watching a literal paper presentation, because everything is digital nowadays and you had papers.
Right.
Papers in
your
hands, literally papers in
your hands. I just took a printout today this morning, because I'll not be able to, you know, read it from my tablet or phone.
That was an awesome experience. The paper presentation, literally it was. And it was a very good presentation, sir.
The only thing I felt, I'm
not anyone to suggest or recommend, but I felt that the scope of this paper is a little huge for a research
right,
paper.
Right.
I don't know
right.
how you compressed all this into a single paper.
Right. It, actually, the paper runs for almost 20 pages. It should have been a book chapter rather.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it has been very difficult on my part actually to compress all the things into this, and it is much more harder on my part to depict in such a short span of time to cover up all the things. Right.
Yeah,
yes. It's very difficult.
Actually, we need more time, like half an hour paper presentations.
Right, absolutely.
But
yes,
then,
yes, absolutely.
How will we give opportunities to more people? There are so
right,
many concerns
right.
for the organizers. I guess there are constraints. Anyway, that was very interesting.
And sir, I feel privileged to have given me this chance. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, to the organizers. Hand over the...
Yes, yes. Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. That was nice, sir. Thank you so much. So, the next paper presentation is by Aruna Devi S. She's an MPhil research scholar, and she is going to tell us a little bit about the struggle and self-realization in Geeta Hariharan's, The Thousand Faces of Night. Okay, struggle and self-realization in Geeta Hariharan. Yes. Are you here? Will we have an absence for the first time today? Oh, wow. Aruna Devi, are you here? I think no. Okay, Bhavatharani B, MPhil research scholar, she will tell us about the evolution of the feministic desire. Evolution of the feministic desire. Bhavatharani B. Are you here? Okay, who is here? Aruna Devi, Bhavatharani, both of you are not here. Then Dr. C. Chitra, she's an assistant professor in English. Anjali, you will get one more chance, definitely. So Dr. C. Chitra, she is... are you here, Anjali, Dr. Chitra?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah,
yes, I'm here, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am will be presenting a paper on trauma of partition in Manju Kapoor's Difficult Daughters. Okay. Trauma of partition. Yes, ma'am. Please.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I thank the organizers of JP College, Tengasi, for conducting an international virtual conference and allowing me to participate and present a paper. Partition has been one of the most contested issues in English literature. Women writers succumbed to partition. Manju Kapoor is one of the renowned writers of the contemporary era. This novel, Difficult Daughters, won the 1999 Commonwealth Prize. This novel is the story of a young woman's search for independence in a time when the path of a woman's future was not her own. Virmadi, a young Punjabi girl born in Amritsar, the eldest daughter of Kasturi and Suraj Prakash, was busy looking after her siblings. She could not do well in her studies. She fell in love with a professor who was already married. Her parents came to know this and arranged a marriage for one engineer in the JIT. Due to the death in his family, the marriage was postponed. Meanwhile, Virmadi denied marriage and wanted to study further. Later, Virmadi married the professor and gave birth to a girl, Ida. This novel brings together three generations of women. So this novel is set in India in the 1940s. The search for one's identity, to control one's destiny, is the theme of this novel. This novel is set in Punjab in the 1940s, and it describes the life of Virmadi against the backdrop of political happenings before and after partition. Once, when Britishers ruled our country, all Indians, whether they are Hindus, Muslims and Sikhs, they fought against the British. But the situation turned away after the partition. In Amritsar, one could see the hidden jealousy and hatred for the minority communities. In this novel, vengeance made the people throw bombs, poison the wells, create mistrust among the other castes and communities. The characters, two characters in this novel, Swarna and Ashrafi, were very close friends before partition. They were Hindu, one was a Hindu and another a Muslim. But after the partition, they behaved in a different way. So the concept of partition is very clearly dealt with in the 25th chapter. So there, the author felt the word partition appeared in all the newspapers. And in Lahore, two gentlemen refused to eat just because the food which was being served was by a Muslim. And in this novel we find, or later on, women's education brought independent thinking. So Virmadi wanted to tackle her problems on her own. Independence was given for Virmadi. The partition issue led to death, massacre and bloodshed. Kasturi insisted that Virmadi should be brought back to her native place, but the idea of traveling with these two wives made Harish shiver, and he could not travel. Virmadi misused her freedom to education and independence. In the struggle for freedom, India lost thousands of innocent lives due to communal riots and hatred. Virmadi lost a part of herself and went into depression. The vision of independence, instead of the dawn of a new era, turned into a sad tale of misery. Partition should never take place in any part of the world. History can be repeated if the separatists persist on an individual status. The fiction written in this period helped the readers to understand the psychological trauma of the women victims of the partition. Thank you, sir. Thank you, organizers.
Okay, ma'am. That was concise. That was well presented as well.
Time shortage, I very briefly summarized.
That was so considerate of you to do that. And you presented it, the whole story was summarized very beautifully. So the idea was summarized very beautifully. So it was very nice. Of course, thank you so much for that presentation. We don't have any questions. I think everything was clear. That was very good. And the last presentation in this session, not for today. Okay, ma'am. Thank you. And the next one, 17th, Miss Noble A. Paliyat. She's an assistant professor, and she will tell us about the lure of the normal, researching depictions of disability in young adult graphic narratives. New topic. Researching depictions of disability in select young adult graphic narratives. Students, please listen, it will be very useful. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Shall I start?
Yeah, sure, ma'am.
Am I audible?
Yes, not visible, audible.
Okay, so I would like to share my screen.
Yeah, definitely.
Shall I do so?
Yeah, sure.
Is the screen visible?
Okay, it is visible. Please continue.
We live in a world of norms. Each of us endeavors to be normal, or else deliberately tries to avoid that state. We consider what the average person does, thinks, earns, or consumes. There is probably no area of contemporary life in which some idea of a norm, mean, or average has not been calculated. To understand the disabled body, one must return to the concept of the norm, the normal body. So much of writing about disability has focused on the disabled people as the object of study. I would like to focus not so much on the construction of disability as on the construction of normalcy. I do this because the problem is not the person with disabilities. The problem is the way that normalcy is constructed to create the problem of the disabled person. Jots down Leonard J. Davis in his seminal and influential book entitled The Disability Studies Reader. Dear all, good afternoon. I am Ms. Noble A. Paliad, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Sacred Heart College for Women, Chalakudi, Thrissur, Kerala, India. I'm here to present a paper entitled The Lure of the Normal, Researching Depictions of Disability in Select Young Adult Graphic Narratives. I would like to hold on this particular slide for a few minutes. On close scrutiny, it becomes evident that three different areas of focus are graphically represented. The first one is, of course, a graphic description of the emerging area of academic discipline called graphic novels. The second one is an image description of yet another trending realm of knowledge labeled as disability studies. And the third one is, however, a pictorial presentation of the notion of normalcy. In sum total, I have endeavored to unearth and unveil that critical and central nexus shared among the three interlinked and intertwined epistemological concepts like graphic novels, disability studies, and normalcy. Now, conveying the same idea but in a different phraseology, the current study is an exploratory attempt to scrutinize and address representations of disability in the amazing range of select young adult graphic narratives by unfolding the aura that is associated with the mysterious and enigmatic term normalcy. The chosen few from among the whole list of young adult graphic novels documenting the disability experience include Regifters, Crossing Midnight Volume 1, The Plain James, Blue Beetle Shell Shocked, Robo Dreams, Beth Jr., Batman Secrets, all graphic narratives published in the year 2007. Now let me make a passing reference to the chosen primary sources, Mark Hempel's, Mike Carey's, and Sonny Liu's Regifters. Figures of female with disability presented as Jim Ferns and Eric Nguyen's Crossing Midnight Volume 1 figures a male with disability presented as visual impairment. Cecil M. Castellucci's and Jim Rugg's The Plain James figures a male with disability presented as other health impairment in the form of coma. Keith Giffen's and John Roger's Blue Beetle Shell Shocked figures two females with disabilities presented as orthopedic impairment, in the sense uses a wheelchair, and visual impairment. Sarah Warren's Robo Dreams figures a character of indeterminate gender with disability presented as orthopedic impairment in the form of paralysis. Gary Vitas and Ted Nafis, Death Jr., figures two males with disabilities presented as other health impaired, in the sense connected to tubes and twins attached at the head. And the last and final primary source, both Kane's and Sam Cade's Batman Secrets, figures a male with disability presented as emotional disturbance. Now over to the objectives of the research article. The current study intends to focus on the way disability is portrayed in graphic narratives read by young adults, as they constitute an even larger population of individuals with disabilities. It intends to find answers to a few set of troubling questions like nature, range and type of disabilities, whether one disability received more attention than others, detection of a systemic pattern in the treatment of disabilities, whether there is a deviation from the hitherto followed preset and predetermined pattern of representing disability by perpetrating stale stereotypes and stigmas. The study also focuses on the problematic and irresistible force of normalcy. Over to the findings of the research article. The findings are: characters with disabilities like orthopedic, other health, visual, multiple, hearing, speech impairments, emotional disturbance, traumatic brain injury are represented in the graphic narratives. Males and characters include both males and females with disability. However, males are presented as evil and females as pitiable. Most of the portrayals fit a negative stereotypical image. The disabled are presented as abnormal as opposed to the able-bodied being depicted as normal. And there is one more finding. Characters are defined by their disability. Disability was not considered as one aspect of their individual traits. To conclude, literature is a potent weapon capable of instigating change. By juxtaposing key areas like graphic narratives and disability studies and a concept like normalcy, the endless possibilities for creative expression offered by graphic narratives, unequal and unfair treatment experienced by disabled people, fluid nature of identity, an attempt to erase the boundaries between the abled and the disabled are examined in detail. The current trend is one of inclusion, accommodation, acceptance, and tolerance. An attempt to highlight and foreground the historical specificity, contemporaneity, and hegemonic notions of normativity denaturalizes it, thus reframing ableism as an issue that concerns everyone. My research article comes down as a gentle reminder to the truth that there is always a measurable distance between the able and the disabled. The area of the emerging discipline called graphic narratives should also be integrated as part of the curriculum. So this is also one of the aims of the research article. The COVID-19 pandemic has definitely restructured and reframed our hopes and understandings about the conundrums, mysteries, and purposelessness of human life. It has also taught us that there is no one universal normalcy, but coexistence of multiples of new normals. Hopefully, I conclude, inviting all possible explorations and constructive suggestions. Thank you.
I guess everyone enjoyed the presentation. It was very good. It was very interesting. And the findings were startling. In the comment box, you can find all the positive, Deepthi says, relevant and ingenious presentation, such an enlightening presentation. We have a lot of comments. That's an amazing presentation, ma'am. It was very good, beautifully presented. And the findings were really startling. I'm not asking you, but it was startling that men were represented as evil and women were represented as pitiable. And you never knew that, right? I don't think anybody knew that disability had such connotations, and especially in graphic novels. It was amazing. It was wonderful. Hi, Beta. Nice. Your daughter.
Thank you.
Okay, ma'am.
I proposed the research thesis.
Okay.
I'm doing my PhD in this area.
Okay. All the best, ma'am. Thank you so much. It was a very nice presentation. Now, we move on to one presentation that was skipped in between because of network issues. Anjali S., a puppet play of a woman, a character study of Ponna of One Part Woman by Perumal Murugan. Are you here? Anjali?
Yes, sir. Am I audible now?
Yeah, you are.
I think
you
so.
Are, you are.
Okay, yes. Sir. Sorry for the inconvenience caused by my... Okay, sir. So, due to the time limit, I'm giving only a brief overlook to my article. So, we know One Part by Perumal Murugan, and it is notorious for its portrayal of that ritual, such things. So, I'm not at all going deep into the summary of that novel. I'm just giving a brief summary of my research paper. So, here I am giving a rereading of some female characters, especially Ponna. Sir, am I audible?
Yeah. Yes, you are. Please go ahead.
Okay, sir. Okay, especially Ponna. So, I am looking at them. So, they are made to be doll-like characters by the patriarchy. Of course, in an uneducated, cultured society, women are considered as marginalized, inferior. So, the same thing has happened to the case of Ponna and other women characters. So, in the beginning itself, we can see Ponna. She is the wife of Kali, the sister of Muthu. She is born and brought up in a very patriarchal society. And she is always accused for her barrenness. She can't able to give birth a child. So everybody's curse. Everybody used to curse her because of her barrenness. The thing that only Ponna has to face all these sufferings. For Kali. Kali is her husband, and Kali. For Kali, second marriage is given as a solution for this childlessness. So, such things are there. But every woman, not Ponna, but other women also, they are made to be puppet-like toys in order to play in the society. Such things are there. So, Ponna, if from the beginning itself, we can see Ponna, how she is marginalized, even by women. So, when Kali and Ponna are invited to take part in a ceremony, she is kept away by another woman because she can't able to bear a child. So, even women are act as a tools of patriarchy. So, such things are I question in my research paper. I want to find why women are acting like puppets, puppet-like toys. Such things are my thrust area of my paper. So, and in one part of the novel, one woman is the wife of Nallavan. He's an iconoclast, but even he cannot protect his woman counterpart. So every woman is outcasted. But what I find is that what I made a conclusion is that Ponna is asked to take part in the ritual in the 14th day of that Charis festival, and she's asked to take part in that festival to in order to able to be a mother. So Kali cannot bear that situation, but Pona is ready to take part in that ritual because she wants to give an heir to Kali. So she is ready to take part in that festival, and she goes there. But that thing, the only thing that Pona made in her life, the only decision that Pona take in her life is that in choosing a mate or choosing a god. So she is in search of a man suitable to her, and she is also trying to find a man resembling Kali. So at last she can find a man, and the man gives her a name, Shelby. She was called as Shelby by the god. God means the man she chose, and this name Shelby, the new name, is in a sense a transformation to Pona. She can enjoy the ritual, and she is in a sense transformed into another self. She is begin to enjoy the festival. She wants to keep loud her voice, and she wants to break all the chains surrounding her, such things. So the in the eyes of everyone, especially in the eyes of Kali, Pona is doing a unethical thing, but for Pona it's a kind of transformation. So in order to be a mother, she is doing all these things, but it gives her a new identity, a new name, and a new self. So this is the conclusion I have found in my research paper. So this is a brief idea of my research paper, sir. Because of time, I'm just give the thrust area of my paper.
Okay, that was good, well presented.
Okay, thank you, sir.
I hope Perumal Murugan will be happy listening to your presentation.
And, okay, sir, thank you.
Just a question, have you seen, sir? Have you gone through the sequels, the two sequels?
No, sir, I okay. Don't get a copy of that.
Okay, then leave it. When you get time, read it, because there is a lot of controversy around the multiple climaxes.
I read about that, sir, but okay. I cannot get a copy of that book.
Okay, so thank you for that presentation. As you can see here too, electricity has left. So I don't know when my computer is going to die or network connection is going to give up. If in case it does, maybe once it is back, I will inform Mahesh Raja if I have to leave in between. Mahesh Raja will tell you when our paper presentations can resume, because electricity is not in our hands. I'm sitting in the dark, kind of. So the next, whatever we can do, we will do. The next paper presenter, who is there? Yes. Who is going to make the next paper presentation from the next list? I think Jo-Marie Bernardin. Are you here from today's list? Jo-Marie.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can make the presentation. Yes. She's a PhD research scholar, and her paper is titled Nostalgia, Home and Belonging, a Diasporic Reading of Before We Visit the Goddess by Chitra Banerjee Divakarini. Yes?
Sir?
Yes, Mahesh?
Sorry for the interruption.
Yeah.
If you feel so tired, we can keep the second session in the next day. No issues, sir.
Let us see. I think my electricity is no more. Let us see. We will have this presentation when the computer shuts down, we will stop. Okay, you can go ahead.
Thank you, sir. I'm Jo-Marie Bernardin. I'm a research scholar from St. Xavier's College. My presentation topic for today is Nostalgia, Home and Belonging, a diasporic reading of Before We Visit the Goddess by Chitra Banerjee. Chitra Banerjee is a widely researched an author. Here my topic is the nostalgia of home and belonging. I have mainly concentrated on nostalgia. I have divided nostalgia into two types based on the analysis of Bond's theory. Nostalgia is more after diaspora, so I thought of taking it into Chitra Banerjee's novel. Nostalgia is a longing for a home that no longer exists or has never existed. Nostalgia is a sentiment of loss and displacement. I have quoted this from Bond's, quoted in Bond's words. Before we visit the borders, it's a story of migration, dislocation of three generation women. We can notice the loneliness, longing, and nostalgia in the life of three women. The story revolves around the three women. The paper has been divided into two types of nostalgia, restorative nostalgia and reflective nostalgia. Restorative nostalgia is going back to the past or the memories of the home by recreating the memories of home and learning. That is, restoring the past gives the character a relief. That's the brief definition. Analyzing the Before We Visit the Goddess using the definition of restorative nostalgia, it may aptly suit for the character of Savitri. Savitri is the daughter of Durga. She faces many struggles in her life. Her life is full of struggles and drama. She longs to study. Longs to get educated, but her family cannot afford to educate. But finally, she studies with the help of a rich lady, but that doesn't last longer as she falls in love with a rich lady's son and she's sent out of the home and she's taken care of by her professor. Later, she marries himself. The life doesn't stop with her, the trouble doesn't stop with that in her life. She's been her husband and her, she loses her husband and son in a fire accident. Later, she's so much worried that she starts a business in her native, where her mother lived. She is not even able to attend her mother's death. So she goes back to Bengal, her native place, and starts a sweet stall in name of her mother to retain her mother's name and in the name of her mother's memory. This is a perfect example of restorative nostalgia. She longs to have a sweet stall as her mother had. She returns to her native and sets up a sweet stall in the name of her mother in her remembrance. Thus, restoring her past gives her a great relief. The second one is the reflective nostalgia. This type of nostalgia lingers on materials like the ruins of the past. It centers on the longings and made to accept the past as part. It does not rebuild the home like the other one, restorative nostalgia. This type of nostalgia is aware of the gap between the identity and the resemblance. We're looking, analyzing the Before We Visit the Goddess. The second generation woman, that is Savitri's daughters Bila and Savitri's grandmother, granddaughter Tara, are perfect examples of reflective nostalgia. After Savitri's death, both Bila and Tara read the letter written by Savitri along with the photo of the grandmother Savitri. She narrates her life incidents in the letter. Tara likes her photo of the grandmother and wishes to keep it herself as a remembrance, but Bila doesn't approve of it. But somehow she manages to take the photo of her, but Bila finds it out and scolds her. I try to conclude that Bila and Tara knows that they cannot return to the past or they cannot return to the native, but tries to safeguard the ruins, that is the photo of Savitri, and tries to keep her in the memory through the photo. I try to conclude that the Burns types of nostalgia mainly focuses on the individual's emotions, and it is very well portrayed in the novel before we visit the chorus. And thank you. That's all for the presentation. Thank you, sir.
Okay, then that was very good. I think we should stop for the day, for the time being at least.